This week's episode is sponsored by White's Beaconsfield. White's Beaconsfield is the number one company in the UK to brighten up your smile at a very affordable price. Get your perfect smile today using code AGJamesEnglish at checkout for a 15% discount on all products.
White's Beaconsfield. I'm on day 5 out of 7 and my teeth are looking white.
So it doesn't contain peroxide, so it's very, very safe for you to use on your teeth. It doesn't cause any sensitivity and I've literally got the most sensitive teeth.
The most affordable product, works like a dream.
Look how white, with no filter, no sensitivity, and it is just one of the best that I've ever used.
Like, that's 3 days. It's crazy.
You can now follow me on all my social media platforms to find out who my latest guest will be. And don't forget to click the subscribe button and the notifications button so you're notified for when my next podcast goes live.
I used to take myself out and meet other people after football, meet them at Ellen Road, meet them after matches, and just go along. You know, oh, you like a bit of boxing, Ed? Yeah, oh yeah, I fucking love boxing. And that's when things really started to spiral. Fucking 5 weeks later and I'm sat on top table with Eddie, Luke Campbell, Tommy Coyle, Samir. And I got that fight as an opponent. I just drive past Leeds Arena and see it get constructed and think, wow, I'd love to fight there one day. You know, even if I was just on the undercard, just for a bit of history, you know, to say, yeah, I've done that. You know, you see people on TV and everyone instantly thinks that you're a fucking millionaire, yeah. which is far from it. It was far from it, you know. And I was starting to do all right, but I want enough to quit work and everything else. So I was still working. Everything I've ever done up to my career, it's come to that moment, that next fight. And it was a case of, now, that's ultimate bauble. Fucking hell, a world title fight. I never thought when I first started that I'd ever win a world title. Fucking British title with a gold, European, international titles after that were a bonus. All of a sudden, fighting for the fucking biggest bauble in the fucking world, man.
Boom, we're on. Yes, and today's guest, we've got undefeated fighter, Josh Warrington. How are you, brother?
Very well, James, very well. I'm just honoured to hear you say that face to face. But yeah, good to be here, mate. Good to be here. A little bit tired. Trained last night, trained hard. But I can't complain. I'm breathing. I'm alive. So
world title holder.
Yeah, world title holder.
Is Ralph throwing a hand there on that?
World title holder. Just ranked number one in the world. Yeah. But
you're doing amazing, mate.
Thank you.
I watched your film last night as well.
Yes.
Unbelievable. I didn't even know
Did you
had
pay
one
for it?
Out. 350.
Oh, good or man.
350.
Yeah, royalties.
Yeah.
I'll get about 10 pence from that. But
I didn't know you had one.
Yeah.
I seen it last night on your Instagram. It was 2 years to the day, maybe.
Yeah, 2 years today since the premiere. We had a big premiere at Leeds Film Festival, Leeds Town Hall. About 800 or 900 in attendance. End of a bit of a journey that was, that film. He approached us back in 2016. It just wanted to do a little documentary. I found the contract, actually. It was only meant to be 35 days long. It ended up being 3 years of filming, over 250 hours of filming. And an hour and a half film bought by Universal. I've got the film posted in my downstairs toilet.
Unbelievable, isn't it?
So not too bad, mate, yeah.
Doing well for yourself.
Done a DVD, signing
well for yourself. As you know, brother, I always go back to the start of my guests, where you grew up and how it all began.
Yeah, okay. So grew up in Leeds born and bred. So what, fucking scandalous accent. Mum, dad. Two brothers, sister, got an older stepsister. Just council estate kid, working class. One of them kids who had plenty of energy, always running about, playing with playing out with his mates. You know, this were grew up in the '90s, so era before phones and technology took over. You go out from, you know, as soon as you wake up, and you come back in when it gets, when it starts getting dark. Like I say, always a bundle of energy. Started doing a bit of karate because my dad said you need to calm me down a little bit. Felt it wasn't physical enough for me. You know, I always used to like to play fight with my brothers. You know, I always loved to play fight with my brothers. I used to like watch wrestling on telly. And to me, you know, 7-8 year old kid, watching people put steel chairs over each other's head were as realistic and violent as possible. And I used to get hairs in the back of my neck stood up. I think I'd about 5 or 6 when I watched Braveheart. foaming at mouth and stuff like that. So, yeah, I started doing a bit of karate and it wasn't physical enough for me. You know, I wanted to just go in and boot people around head. I thought I was going to be a ninja or something like that. But, you know, there's a little bit of discipline in going into their catas and things like that. So, dad took me to a boxing gym straight after that, 6-7 years old. Big building on York Road, Star Building. It's a gym where Nicola Adams had a, you know, amateur career as well. And I remember walking in there as a young kid, hairs on the back of my neck, stood up, smell of the gym. So lads sparring away and thought, wow, I want to be involved in this. And that's it. Went on from there, mate. Went on from there. Amateur.
How's your schooling?
For a long time and pro. But schooling, fine, mate, fine. I'm going off a little track a little bit here. I've always had a wise head on young shoulders. I think that's one of my assets from being a young kid. I don't know why. I just always switched on, always a wise and awake. Always used to listen to people. Now, going to school, I always wanted to be the best at everything. Just very competitive. Whether it be my punctuality was shit, I was always late, but everything else, I wanted to be best in exams, best in sports and stuff like that. I used to play football, non-stop. You know, absolutely loved playing football. Never good enough to play for a team or anything like that. But I'd play until the cows come home. Just determined to win. Always switched on in school. Always used to listen until around year 8, year 9. And then I think I started to lose track a little bit because I were obsessed with boxing. By that time, I'd got to a good stage in boxing. And I thought I could have gone somewhere. So whilst all my pals and that were knuckling down and getting their heads down for the exams, I was kind of coming away and I would turn up to school like tired, knackered. Because I was obsessed with the boxing. I mean, I was sparring with professionals at like 14, 15. I used to take my trainers to school and I used to run home from school, go to gym after, go training to like 9:30 at night and I should have been revising. And that was it. I just couldn't be arsed with school by the end of it. I had it in my head that we're going to be a boxer. But prior to that, bloody hell, it was just something I used to do. Like I say, in between all that, as a young kid, I used to just knock about on the States with my pals. Boxing always gave me a focus. It always gave me a bit of a distraction, a different way of looking at life, I guess. Because I grew up on the council estate. Grew up in areas where, you know, if your mum and dad are sponging system, you know, you've got nice trainers. If your dad's knocking a bit of this out and that out, you've got nice trainers. My dad grafted and he worked hard and he did best he could for us, but we weren't spoilt. You know, we weren't spoilt. I was talking about with lads and see that they were getting into this and over, even at 13, 14, smoking this, sniffing that, taking a bit of glue, doing whatever, licking car radios, nicking, you know, burgling. But I'd never wanted to be that James, you know. I wanted to be better than that. So I knuckled down at school. I did knuckle down, like I said, until the last bit. And, you know, I thought the boxing would take over eventually.
Yeah. You remember your first time ever sparring?
Yeah.
What was that feeling for you?
So when I first walked into a gym, I was about 4 stone. Yeah, 4 stone. I've always been smaller. I was born premature and I was born with pneumonia on my lungs. So it was touch and go for me. I wouldn't think a bit for the first 5 weeks of my life. So I think they'd said to my mum, wrap him in cotton wool because he's going to be very delicate. I'll get fucking punched to head for a living.
That's unbelievable, mate.
Yeah, I know.
You've been fighting basically since the day you were born.
I think that's in the DNA from the start. I think some things are ingrained into us, and that is certainly one of them. But yeah, like I say, I always enjoyed that, like, play fighting with brothers and stuff. So having that first spar, I think I was first sparred with a girl because none of the lads were small enough for me, and she knocked fucking 7 bells at me. But I wanted to go back, and by the time I was 8 and 9 years old, I started getting a bit bigger. I was very competitive in them things, and, you know, we just knocked 7 bells out of each other, you know, stood there in the gym, gloves on, gloves as big as your arms. If I got hit, I wanted to make sure I hit, you know, that person back. Pretty obsessed. Suffered with a bit of OCD. I still do at times. People like, when you hit me, I don't hit you back twice, and, you know, all about numbers and things like that. But yeah, we just talked. And listen, don't get me wrong, like any other kid, you know, throughout my childhood, there were times when your pals are going out to play, or as you get older, they're going to house parties, dagging about the street. Are you coming out, Josh? Nah, I'm going to the gym. And you think to yourself, why am I doing this? You know, why am I doing this? Everyone's going out. I'm missing out on this. But my old fella used to say to me, listen, if you're going to do it, don't fuck about. He said, don't half do it. Don't waste the time of trainers and the people around. If you're going to do it, you have do it 100% or don't do it at all. And listen, there were times at like 11 or 12 when we're getting to high school, I thought, shall I go play football, mate? Just pack the boxing in. But I could never let it go. I was obsessed with it. Always wanted to go to the gym. I missed it when I wasn't doing it. You know, when my dad said, like, that's it, I ain't fucking taking you to the gym. You're not going again. I'd miss it, and I'd want to go back again. So, yeah.
So just a passion
just,
for
just
it.
And a love. Massive passion, a massive passion, yeah.
Like your dad, I watched the, and he seems awful strict, bang on the money when it comes to certain things. When did he always train you at a certain age, or did he start getting involved in the latter stages in your life?
No, he used to just take me to gym. He used to just take me to gym, drop me off, and that was it. And I think by the time 11 and 12, he started getting involved with some of the lads in gym just because he'd seen the way that the lads had been trained. Now, he didn't have a massive boxing background. His little bit was probably the comparison to white collar, you know? Yeah. Bit of like, you know, get your gloves on. You're fighting working men's clubs and stuff like that. He was a doorman for many years. Back in the time when doormans used to have scraps with people
outside. Didn't need a license.
No, didn't need a license. Yeah, that would it. Worked up and down country. You know, in the days where after they knocked fuck out someone, you know, normally shake a hand and they can speak to them next week, not have to worry about getting stabbed next week. You know, and a lot of things. What my dad does is it simplifies things, and that's what he was doing. He was helping out some of the lads in the gym, and the next minute he's become a trainer. The next minute, you know, he's looking after my career as well, but. It's not always been easy having my dad in my corner. As much as people may think, you know, oh, your dad's your training, oh, it must be easy, or maybe get.
No,
to,
that makes it worse.
Yeah, listen, mate, it's fucking horrible because I've always had it hard off me old fella. Oldest out my two brothers and my sister. It's always like I've had to set an example, and I was like my dad's mate as a kid. You know what I mean? I used to go with him here, there, and everywhere, and we had like it was with. From a father and son relationship, like we were pals, you know. And when I went to gym, I got it harder than anyone else. Listen, I get like an hard sparring session, 10, 11 years old, and you've got a bust nose, black eye, and you're sulking, you know, you're fucking holding back the tears, you're in pain or whatever. And he's like, that was fucking terrible. And then you're going to get a bollocking card as well. But gives you a thick skin.
Tough love.
Yeah, very tough love. And at the time, you can't see that. I said, fucking hell, I'm getting a right roasting from my old fella, get home, animosity in house, you know, my man, what's he done now? Why? Fucking scandalous, wasting my time going to the gym, but I wouldn't have had that any other way because I see that in this day and age, a lot of people are mollycoddled and they don't like failure. And as soon as they do get a bit of criticism, that's it, they're fucking panicking and they can't take it. You know, I think you need to go through these obstacles to build a bit of resilience. And to bounce back from, and that's certainly what I did with my old fella. Yeah.
Well, clearly, look, he's moulded you into being, you've clearly hard working graft, but undefeated world champion of the world at 29.
Yeah.
30 and 14th of November.
I know my shit, mate. It's staring at 30 down the barrel.
It's tough love, but a bit of reverse psychology as well, where, you know, he clearly seen the passion, the ability,
that you could have been. And it is difficult to work with family because there's always arguments and fights, but he's there's obviously a trust there.
Yeah, most definitely.
You know what I mean? Where most definitely. It's hard to trust anybody, but if it's your dad, then it's a different ball game.
Listen, throughout the years, fucking hell, we've had stand-up rows. We've had absolute stand-up rows. I mean, fucking times. Because what happens is, he's brought me up. So his values have been ingrained into me. But when you get to an age, you become your own man, don't you? You know, as a young kid, you think you know things, but you don't know fuck all as a teenager. But when you start getting into your early 20s and stuff, then you've lived a bit of life. So you become your own person. And when he's saying certain things to you, you think, no, that's not right. But he's a proud man as well. He's old school, you know. If he's right, he's fucking right. And if he's on that opinion, he's going with it till cows come home. Even if he's wrong, factually he's wrong, he'll still argue that he's right. And there's been times in camps where we've had fucking stand-up rows, mate. But when the arm gets lifted at the end of the fight, it's all forgot about and we never talk about it again. It's just part of parcel. Yeah. It just makes it a bit sweeter.
Has he got a different name? You've got different names?
He has, mate, yeah.
Why is that?
As I was born, him and my mum went together and then he'd come back on the scene and I think at the time she'd registered me without his name and I've never just got it changed over. You see.
What about your first professional fight? Do you remember the details?
Oh, yeah. I mean, fucking hell. We're going to go that far forward. We're coming up to being a pro. I was never the most talented of amateurs, James. They're never the most talented of amateurs. I just worked hard. I've just worked hard.
Was Olympics or anything in Commonwealth? No, never on your radar?
From a young kid. I had an ambition at 11 years old, so I'm trying to patch it together without going on for too long. So as a young kid, started my boxing, 11 years old, had my first fight, amateur, 28 kilos, like I say, fucking walked to the ring. Has a few, six, ten fights, whatever, and I've won a national title. So I'm thinking, fucking hell, I want to represent my country. I want to wear an England vest. You used to see the lads who represented country, they'd walk in, fucking badges on the shorts, you know, England vest on, all that bollocks. And that's where I want to be. And then I won a championships at 15, and I never got a call. And there were a lot of politics in game at the time. Just become a bit disillusioned with it. You know, it fucking devastated, really. You know, I was expected to go on to fight for four nations and all that didn't happen. So it was just for myself. And then I'm like 15, 16, I'm sparring professionals, you know, likes of Jason Booth, Dale Robinson. These guys were fighting for British titles on Sky Sports. And I'm thinking, bloody hell, I'm being asked to go and spar with them and I'm holding my own with them. So it was inevitable that I was going to be a professional boxer, but that was still 2 years away, you know, 16 years old. You've got to wait a long time and that feels like a lifetime away. I can become a dental technician in between that. I worked as a dental technician for 7 years, even throughout my pro career. And 18 year old, we've turned pro and we're on our way.
It's early, isn't it?
Yeah, it is early, but I wasn't...
Did that dishearten you, getting a knockback?
Not really. Not really. Listen, at times I mean, I think back a little bit upset.
Or did it kick you on to go? I was a little bit upset,
but yeah, we've got to do better. Yeah. Oh, I'm not going to be a pro, then we've got to make some out of this. I'm not going to be a top class amateur. I'm not going to go to Olympics. Then I'm going to make some out of the fucking professional game, and that was it. And listen, James, I never set massive goals. I'd set little small goals. When I turned pro, 18. I'd my last amateur fight as an 18 year old. I boxed Tom Stalker, who went on to represent Great Britain Olympics. He beat me in semi-finals of the ABAs. Fucking apparently I didn't score a point in the last round. I mean, I've got it, I'm still on DVDs. I don't know how fucking, is that, I'm bouncing right hands off his fucking head and I still didn't score a point. But that was the politics in the game at the time. After that, I was like, right, I'm turning pro. Sat down with my manager, who's still my manager to this day. He said, are you not good at anything else? Because there's fuck all money in this boxing game. I said, listen, all I want to do is try winning a British title. If I can get enough money to get a house deposit and a car and drive, then I'll be an happy man. And that were it. That were all my goal, whatever it was. It wasn't fucking world title. It wasn't thousands of followers on social media. I didn't want to be famous. You know, just house and car. That was it. That was all my goals were. You know, small little goals. And that was the journey from there on.
Because you went right through from British title, Commonwealth, European. You never done, was it British and European?
Yeah, I had English, British, Commonwealth, European, WBC International and world titles.
So you've done it proper.
Did
you, for any young boys maybe watching, boxers, and a lot of people think maybe going the Olympics route, amateur route, you've done it turning pro 18, and I know a lot of people go right through to where you are today. Do you think there's a big difference?
No, I think you don't have to have that amateur background, because I say the name there, Tom Stalker, he were fucking a very decorated amateur, and now Tom's a good lad, but he didn't make it as a pro. His style didn't transition over. One of me and lads were on about in the gym last night, Naya Nui, who was fucking world boxing champion, super series champion, sorry, unified champion. He didn't have a massive amateur experience. Don't think you do have to have a massive amateur experience. Don't get me wrong, it does give you some fundamentals. I learned a lot as a young amateur, sparring like the pros and stuff like that, bloody hell. And I think what you get there, you get a little bit of resilience and things like that, you know, you get a strong mindset. But I don't think, if you don't have that amateur background, then you don't have to worry too much about it. Because like I said, a lot of them talented amateurs are a lot better than me, better footwork, faster, stronger, and they haven't made it in the pros. When I've been able to go on throughout the years, developing myself, taking myself away and learning my trade that way.
Yeah, do you think you've matured a lot quicker at 29 to be an established world-class fighter now, instead of the people who's went through the amateurs first?
Yeah, definitely. Listen, I had a long route getting up to the world level, James, a long route. So, you know, 18 having my pro fight. For about 2 years, I was learning my trade. And like a lot of people look at my record and they see that there's not a lot of knockouts on that record. And the reason being is a lot of my fights were against tough, like journeymen and prospects. So you see a lot of fighters, like you might have someone who's just turned pro, he's had a decorated amateur background, he's got sponsors coming out of his arsehole, he's signed already, Eddie's talking, this is the fucking business, this man here, this is the business. And you know, he's got videographers with him, he's got like a verified tick on social media, and he's getting thrown into these fights and he's blasting out these like Eastern Europeans who are coming over for a pay date. As soon as he gets into a proper fight a few years down the line, because he gets fast-tracked, it gets found out. And that's what happens to a lot of these fighters. Whereas me, I come from a long way around. So I had two fights against like reasonable journeymen who just kind of show you the ropes. But then my third fight were against another lad from Leeds, prospect, who like won a no himself. Then my fourth fight were against a geezer who were 29, age 29. It was his first pro fight. He'd brought a few fans. So these are fights were competitive and we're only four rounders. But at the same time, I wouldn't have been gifted the win. I wasn't gifted like knockout wins. It was never written. I still had a bit of a tough fight in front of me. And I was a fucking boy at 18, James, you know what I mean? Fucking hell, I'd had a nerd on my knacker. Never mind, body physique, you know what I mean? These guys were fit guys. And in pro boxing, little things can happen where you're in close range and elbows can go in, heads can go in. A referee will just let it play out. You know, especially when you're on undercard, you haven't got the pressure of the TV cameras or behind closed doors, in smaller leisure centres. You know, you're having a little scrap and elbows can, like I say, it's physical. And I would try to wrestle with these men here, you know what I mean? And I learned a lot through that. Every fight I'd done in the early stages, I'd learned a lot. So by the time I'd come to my first title a few years down the line, I was seasoned. You know, I'd done the rounds, I'd had fights where, you know, I've done my six rounders, I've done my four rounders, I've done them at a high pace as well. The next fight up after that is 10 rounder for the championship fight. But I was, you know, 2.5 years down the line as a pro, I'd had 11 or so fights in other people's backyards and I was seasoned and ready for that.
How was it at your first 15 fights? We'll touch on later, obviously, the mass following you've got.
Yeah.
Not just all around Britain now, you've got mega following because of some of the fights you've had over the last couple of years. But now you've got a massive backing from Leeds.
Mm-hmm.
When did that start for you? How many fights deep?
Listen, I've always been obsessed about where I come from. about where I come from. As a young kid, I was always obsessed with like Leeds. I used to pick up the boxing news, which is, for those who don't know, it's like it's biggest publication in Britain for boxing. It's been going since 1909, I think. So it's widely known as a boxing news, and I used to pick it up and go to amateur section and always see lads from Manchester, Sheffield, Liverpool, London always get a shout out, but never lads from Leeds. And I always used to watch boxing with my old fella on Chips Cable Box and wonder, you know, why is there never fighters from Leeds on? It's always Liverpool, Manchester, London. And I always used to think to myself, hey, if I ever turn pro, then I want to try put Leeds on the map. Around the time of 11 and 12 when I used to say things like that, Leeds were fucking champions of Europe, or the giants of Europe in terms of the football side. So that would always it. Wanted to have a big, not a big following. I just wanted to establish Leeds as a decent boxing city. You know what I mean? If I could get a fight, a British title fight, and the Sky cameras are coming to Leeds, and happy days. So as a young lad, I understood the game. I understood what it was all about. You know, you have to get people to come along and support you and things like that. I never thought it would get to the stage where I'm fucking selling out arenas and things like that, but wow, he's here. But it was a slow process, James. You know, I used to go about to pubs all around Leeds. So I had a base of my good pals, lads off at estate, lads who I'd met from school, lads who I'd worked with. But I used to take myself out and meet other people after football, meet them at Ellen Road, meet them after matches. I just go along, you know. Oh, you like a bit of boxing, yeah? Yeah. Oh, yeah, I fucking love boxing, yeah. Oh, I love it. I used to love watching Nigel Benn and fucking Chris Eubank back in the day. So, listen, I'm trying to, yeah, listen, that's me there. I'm showing them little clips on my phone and stuff. All I'm trying to do, mate, is fucking put City on map. But yeah, listen, I'll come along to your next fight. And it seemed to just snowball from there. You know, people sometimes think from outside, oh, Josh Warrington, he's got all them Leeds fans behind him because he's a Leeds United fan in his associated club, but it wasn't always like that. Fucking hell, my pal was sat in corner over there. I remember times when me and him were fucking going around City Centre, you know, putting flyers up in kebab takeaways and curry houses and handing them out at shopping centres like White Rose Shopping Centre, putting flyers on fucking cars, getting a call from general manager after, listen, we're going to fine you if you keep doing this because it's illegal flyering and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, that's what you have to do. What I was doing is putting myself about, building relationships with people. And some of these people I've met throughout the years, I can call very, very good friends now. Some of them like family. But they've been on my journey for a long time, because what would happen is they'd come watch me fight. Fucking hell, I've had a good night watching that, Josh. Nick, let me know next time, I'll come along. And then they tell his mate, they need to tell his mate, they need to tell his mate. And it kind of mm-hmm. snowball. By the time I come to my first title fight, you know, I had a decent crowd go with me to down to Dudley for an English title. And then by the time I come back to Leeds, I fought at Leeds Town Hall. I think there were about 700 there that night. So, you know, it took a while to get going. But yeah, it was all worth putting in them hard hours, because, like I said to you earlier, I was working as a dental technician as well. So when I left school, it was, like I say, it was 2 years before I turned pro, and I didn't know what the fuck I wanted to do. Like, a lot of kids don't know what to do. You know, my school want the best of schools, and career officers were like, they just wanted to get you out of fucking school as quick as possible. Seeing lads that I grew up with, like, started doing this, doing that. I grew up around people knocking fucking drugs out and stuff like that, and it never interested me. It never interested me. Some of my best pals at the time were doing it, and I just didn't, I wasn't asked about it. You know, listen, they were my best pals, and they were taking it, they were knocking it out, but that kind of lifestyle were never for me. I just thought there's more to it here. Like I said, I had a wise head on young shoulders. People used to say to me as a young kid, after I had amateur fights, they used to come out and say, hey, keep doing what you're doing. And I'd hear it constantly, working men's clubs up and down country, keep doing what you're doing, hey. Fucking, if I could have my time again, you know, I'd have carried on doing what I'm doing. I wish I'd have carried on playing football. Whatever it is, everyone seemed to have this bit of regret of not putting their time and energy as a youngster into what they used to do. Fucking hell, got drawn into this to pick up the pints in Wickham's Club, or fucking hell, you know, you've got to be careful with these, pointing to the missuses. You've got to be careful with your women. And like I used to say to my fellow, fucking hell, Dad, they always keep saying this. I've heard it again tonight. They always keep saying to me, and my old fellow used to say to me, listen, it goes quick. It goes quick. You won't realise now because you're only young, but when you get older, you know, as soon as you get like past 21, you'll realise how fast life goes. He says, opportunities, you know, very, very thin. They come very, there's only few and thin opportunities, and you've got to fucking take them whilst they're there. So, like I say, as a young kid, I kind of...
Did that scare you? Seeing the old of their dreams and ambitions just taken away, drinking it away, did that kind of give you the inspiration to...
I just wanted to bet on that. Because like, you had lads on the state who thought they were bigger than what they are because they had a brother who was fucking quite handy, you know, may have been cocky at state, so that lad thought he was fucking bee's knees, didn't have to talk to anybody in groups. Sometimes you're just in a product of your environment, aren't you? And you grew up with them people, so you grew up in an estate, you hang about with people off your estate. Quickly realise that, fucking hell, this is not what I want to be. Yeah.
You get into pubs and the people say, I could have been a contender, I could have been a football player, but they already know, this is what for anybody watching, even though this was 20, 30 years ago, people in their 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s saying that shit, you know what went wrong, so why not utilise that then to now do something more productive with your life and learn from those mistakes? There's not too many people just give up because they could have been something in their teens or early 20s, and then they forget that they're still alive, they can still do something with
exactly.
their life.
The life's not over.
Yeah,
the
life's not over. You hear that all the time, but you're one in a million for people to go, I'm not going to be here, I don't want to do this life.
Well, this is it, and I didn't realise at the time that I had something maybe different than the most. I thought everyone had ambition, I thought everyone wanted to be better than themselves. You know, I used to look at folk and think like, fucking hell, you know, 10 years time, this will be a lot different. I was a fucking weird kid, me, James. When I was 6 or 7 years old, I used to just think to myself, why the fuck are we here? I used to be like deaf and that scared me, you know. I've always been a family man, I've always been close with my brothers and my sister. I still am now, you know. So I had a different outlook on other people, even though I hung about with them same people from the States. I could see down the line, you know.
See
I could
the world
see.
Differently from
yeah,
everyone
yeah,
else.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So like I got into, you know, at 16, I could just do this and other for a few years and then, you know, turn pro. Because if you're not turning pro with, you know, as a massive ticket seller, as at the first, you know, your first fight, or you haven't got sponsors coming out your backside, then it costs you to go training, it costs you to get your equipment, it costs you to get your medicals and things like that. And, you know, I couldn't just rely on my parents and stuff like that. So I got a job as a dental technician, and it turned out I was just going to be a bit of an assistant in the lab, just cleaning up and stuff like that. And I was 17, I started working as a dental technician, realised that I could make myself fucking plenty of new gum shields. and that way, I just got hooked in that. And people who don't know what a dental technician is, basically, because I fucking didn't know when I was applying for it. Basically, if you get your tooth knocked out, you go to a dentist, they take an impression, they send it away, they make a model of that, and then that's when I worked in a lab, and we fucking just you'd make like a gold crown, veneers and stuff like that, whitening trays, and then we'd send them back to the dentist. So that's what I did. Worked in a lab, I worked for about 3 months, and Gaffer said, listen, you look like you've got a bit of an eye to this, you know, quite academic at school, and you know, not too much of a daft lad, I could pick it up quite quickly. He said, listen, if you want to go forward into it, you need to be qualified into it. So I ended up doing 4 years at Leeds University as well as turning pro at the same time. So listen, them times as a young pro, fucking hell, James, the hardest times of my life. You know, when I talk about now and the big fights what I'm building for, it's a luxury because I get to train fucking full time and stuff like that, and I've got a team around me. But them times, especially when you're just a young lad at 21 year old and I'm fucking getting up, going for the run, getting home, shower, going to work, coming home, stuck in rush hour traffic, fucking getting to gym.
Was that a decision that you might have just give up boxing to go?
Nearly.
Go.
Nearly, mate, nearly. Because it was like, I was earning money there. I was earning money as a dental technician, and obviously you could go higher and higher, and I wanted to be better than everyone else. I wanted to be a fucking, you know, I wanted to be good at my job, and I was starting to progress in the lab doing better and better. And you know, as a professional, as a young professional, you're like getting £1,000 a fight. You know, if you get to a TV slot, you might get 1,800 quid, but you've still got to pay percentages away and then what a training camp costs. And really, and truthfully, it's not too much when you take away cramps and then you've got medical bills at the end of the year, you've got a licence fee, that costs like £2,000 a year. So if you haven't put away from that, then you're fucking, you're not earning much. Mm-hmm. You're not earning much. And listen, there were times like a young 18, 19, 20 year old where I'm thinking, fucking hell, from young kid, I never used to drink at house parties. I never had a drag of a cig. When all lads were passing a spliff around, I never bothered with that. Now I'm 18, all my mates are going out partying. They're all going to town, 19, 20, 21, going to these different things. And I'm seeing on fucking social media that they're doing all these things and fucking hell, what am I doing this for? All I'm doing is working and training. And you can't see, like, obviously down the line, you've got goals and ambition. I wanted to win a British title, but sometimes it becomes difficult. And
it's lonely.
It is lonely, mate. It is lonely because, you know, I'd met my now missus, my now wife. I'd met her and we were trying to have a relationship. And it was difficult. I mean, she worked as a chef as well. But like 6 days in a week, we'd be training and work. And then on my day off, I'd be either studying for university or I'd be trying to go around Leeds, selling myself, you know, try build a fan base and things like that. I always just say to myself, fucking hell, it'll be worth it. All these hard miles, it'll be worth it. It'll be, you know, time and energy, it'll be worth it. And down the line, it did turn out to be okay. But at the time, fucking hell, it would have struggled.
Question
that. Oh, most definitely. I used to think to myself, someone's got to give. You know, just struggling to get into the gym, tired, coming to work next morning with fucking black eyes, sore body, ribs sore, you know, because you're putting hard, in the hard miles, whether it's sparring or circuits or whatever, and then you're going to university on one day a week and you're fucking falling asleep in lectures, you know, blagging through assignments and things like that. And it's like, how long can this go? And then it was a turning point. I picked up one of my pals I was selling tickets to, coming to one of my fights, one of my school pals, and it was about 3 weeks before the fight, so I'm dropping tickets off. And they said, "How are you doing?" I said, "Yeah, not so bad, mate. I'm not so bad." He said, "You ready for it?" He said, yeah, I'm training hard, mate. Just a bit tired. I mean, listen, we're all fucking proud of you. So yeah, whatever. And I said, "Looking forward to this party anyway. I think there were someone's big 21st birthday." And he said, yeah, fucking same old. I mean, yeah, it should be good though. Everyone's gonna be there, you know. Everyone's gonna be all fucking have a good time and that. And tell them we're all, you know, asking for them. Tell them I said hello and that. I said, "Josh, listen. Don't be fucking bothered about that. Don't be bothered about it." He said, "Listen, any one of us would give up what we're doing right now to be in your fucking position." He said, "Listen, look at me. I should have been fucking playing football at an high level, but, you know, it's been the same old since 18-year-old, getting pissed every weekend. It's like same faces." He said, "Everyone's proud of you, mate. And I tell you what, that gave me a fucking kick up at the arse when I most needed it." Mm-hmm. Because you're thinking, fucking hell, why are you doing this? Why, you know, you don't seem to be getting any fucking closer to your end goal. Mm-hmm. But
every day you weren't drinking or smoking
spliffs. No.
It's taking you closer to your goal.
Exactly. But sometimes you don't realise at the time, and sometimes you need that outside influence to remind you of that. And that would a lad at my own age, 21-year-old, saying, "Look at you, you're fucking doing it, mate. You're going places. Keep at it, we're all proud of you." And I'm like, fucking hell. So I was able to graduate from university after that. It just gave me that fucking bit of energy to get over the finishing line.
Plus, you had something to fall back on as well.
Well, my old fella always used to say that. He said, like, fucking, because I'd gone so far in with the job, like, listen, if it don't work out, you know, you've got to be realistic. You know, if that don't work out, then you've always got that. And around about the time I come for my first title, I graduated from uni. I was still working 5 days a week, but that was it then. And the fan base had really started to grow. And then within that little period from 2013, things really started to fast track. It started to go really, really quick from there. So all the hard miles, all them sacrifices, all them days of done long days, putting time and effort in, traveling about all over, almost falling asleep, were all worth it. And I think sometimes that's what happens. You have to put in them hard miles and, you know, that energy's got to go somewhere. In this universe, that energy's got to go somewhere. And eventually, it'll come back round to reward you. And I went down to Dudley, a box for English title. I got the call on 5 weeks' notice. Now, at the time, I'd been pro 2.5 years. I'd been chomping a bit. I'd done kind of my CV. You know, I'm ready for next stage. I'd had some good fights. I'd boxed some good prospects. I'd had a couple of showings on Sky. and things, the fan base was starting to grow. Got a call at 5 weeks' notice to go down to Dudley. Took an army of 90 odd nutcases down there. Boxed in a venue called The Venue against a lad called Chris Mail down in Dudley. About 1,200 people in there, and 1,100 of were East fans. You know, rest of them were mine. And fucking closed environment, intimidating. It were boy versus man. I'll have to show you some of the pictures after on scales. I don't know how he made fucking 9 stone. He had biceps on biceps. I was like scrawny and skinny, and into his backyard. And it was my first 10-round fight. And it was just a fight. It was just that toe to toe. We knocked 7 bells out of each other. But I won that, drove back to Leeds, thinking, fucking hell, I've done it. Like, I felt like an absolute god going into work on the following Monday. You know, lads, like, champs here, fucking hell, there he goes. Fucking hell, we'll buy you lunch today, pal, we'll buy you lunch, and that was it. But my next fight, Leeds Town Hall, fucking, like I say, 700 people had turned up, word had spread. Social media were really starting to grow up, things like Facebook, putting pictures and videos up.
How many
really
fights was grow. This?
And this were around 14 fights in. Mm-hmm. Things were really starting to grow. You know, people were starting to tell people. I was starting to get, little interviews with local newspapers and things like that. And the fan base was still really starting to get, like, bigger and bigger. So I had Leeds Town Hall. I had a defence there, a fella called Jamie Spate. Then I had another one at the Pavilion at Ellen Road. But I've still got my goal on winning the British title, you know. I've not set myself too far in front. It's just that British title's still there, but fucking hell, I'm only one below that, you know. And then I get a call, walking back to the change rooms after my 14th fight against Ian Bailey, and my manager said, how's your hands? I said, all right, they're all good, I feel good. You feeling all right? Yeah, I feel really good. He said, right, nice one, because we've just had a call off Eddie Earn. You've got opportunity to fight for a Commonwealth title in 5 weeks' time over in Hull. Do you want it? So fucking hell, wow, you know, never had me eyes set on that belt, but it's up there, you know, fucking payday, biggest payday whatever he's going to get. So yeah, most definitely, let's have it. And that's when things really started to spiral. Fucking 5 weeks later, and I'm sat on top table with Eddie, Luke Campbell, Tommy Coyle, Samia. And I got that fight as an opponent. I wasn't meant to be there, you know. It was just, I remember Eddie introducing top table. You know, Eddie's fucking got gift at gab. Like, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the old City Town Hall. Let me introduce you to the top table now. To my far left, we've got Josh Warrington down here. English champion, got a bit of following from Leeds. Decent prospect. To my far right, his opponent. Now, when I talk about talent, this man oozes it. Samir Manimni is going to put Hull onto the map. I remember sat there thinking, you fucking wanker.
Blasted,
you
yeah.
fucking wanker. Well, let's see what happens tomorrow. And I remember being there in Hull. I think I took about 150 people over there to support us. Fucking stood there, people hanging over barriers. You dirty Leeds cunt, you're going to get a fucking hiding. I remember stood there nervous as fuck, because I knew that Samir was a very good fighter. Like I say, very, very nervous, but we'll see what happens in there. We'll see what happens in there. We'll see what happens. And as soon as I got in there, like, fucking, yeah, what a tough, tough fight, but just mindset, strong mindset. We're able to go through the trenches and stopped him. Got my first stoppage at fucking 15 fights in, Commonwealth champion. And things went
for. Did that annoy you that Eddie was saying that? Like,
not really, because he didn't know too much about me. You know, I, like I said to you, James, I want a name. I come on from I come from the small halls, so I was just Josh fucking hell at that time. You know, 14-0, no knockouts on record. All right, bit of a fan base, but that's it really. They're not fucking. I didn't talk shit on social media. I just went to Dantwell and Road with my pals, hung about my pals, you know, and went to work, and that was it.
How did Eddie's intro then, after your next fight?
Well, I think a few of my pals went up to him after, and like after the fight, hey, you need to be fucking signing him. So I got an opportunity to fight in Manchester on the Scott Quigg. Scott Quigg were fighting on the main event, and John Murray were fighting Anthony Crawler on that one, which were probably a bad idea because John Murray's a big City fan and Anthony Crawley's a Man United fan. Yeah. I'm a big Leeds fan.
Shout out to Crawler, great guy.
top bloke. And in that arena that night, you had myself, you had fighters from Leicester down there, fighters from London. So they're bringing fans from all over, plus Man City, Man United fans. And 700 of my Leeds fans had gone over, and it was just an absolute carnage after I'd boxed. But I boxed for a number one row, got given an opportunity. after that fight against Samir, or we'll give you another shot, and then we'll let's see how we go on here. Box Rindle, I stopped him in 7 or 8 rounds, retired him on stool, which would a bit crazy really, because going into that fight I was thinking, fucking hell, Rindle Monroe, I remember growing up watching him on telly, you know, going over to Japan and fighting for world titles. He'd been in some absolute barnstormers, and he used to set a crazy pace, and I used to think to myself, wow, fucking hell, that's Rindle Monroe. But the next minute I've stopped him. People are talking on social media, Eddie's speaking very highly of me. This kid's going somewhere, he's got a fan base, he's got an exciting style. Go back to change rooms. Barry Hearn comes in, does a bit of a jig. Fucking Joshy boy! Joshy boy, we're going to Leeds. We're going to Leeds, son. We're going to Leeds. British title, 5 weeks. I'm fucking about it, mate. I'm like, wow, fucking hell. Wow, this is what I've dreamed of. But then my mate was sat in the corner there, he's come in and said, fucking hell, Luke, fucking hell, British title, we're going to be fighting for British title. He went, fucking hell, never mind that. He says, all boys have gone. I said, what do you mean all boys have gone? He says, it's just kicked off bad style in there. It's like WWF. It's come out. There were just patches of empty seats in blocks. Fucking just some of my fans have just kicked off with other fans are putting chairs over each other's head and whatever. But that was it then. That would more or less it. I'd kind of put my foot in the door. I kind of put my foot in the door. I was on my way to fucking achieving my dream. You know, I'd started earning some good purses in the last two fights. Well, I spunked most of them up the wall, but fucking hell, starting to do all right, starting to build a bit of a fan base, more or less, you know, got my foot in with Matchroom in terms of signing contracts and that there. Now, it'd always been a dream of mine to fight at the Leeds Arena, because I drove past it many, many years. Like, I used to work in Adel, North Leeds, and I lived in East Leeds, grew up on York Road near Gipton and went Wybeck East End Park, though, for those who were from Leeds. Shit all areas, but some good people from down there. And I just drive past Leeds Arena and see it get constructed and think, wow, I'd love to fight there one day, you know, even if I was just on undercard, just for a bit of history, you know, to say, yeah, I've done that, you know, take that box off. You know, like, they're all personal goals. Like I said, they never got to represent England as a kid. So getting to fight there would be, oh, fucking hell, you need something to tell your kids about, making memories of life. So I remember them putting a little bit of a promo video of how it looked with a, you know, like animation video of how it looked with rock concerts there and boxing fights there. I thought, oh, fucking hell, that could be me. And like, you've got to picture me and get where I'm at there. I'm fucking like a scruffy dressed lad, because I didn't have too much. I was living in my missus' mum and dad's back bedroom. For 2 years prior to that, I was living in caravan in my dad's back garden. I'm driving a fucking battered Fiat Sesento.
Basically then, homeless?
Well, more or less, yeah. I mean, I used to call it my apartment. That's how I got my missus. I said, listen, you want to come back to my apartment? It was a fucking caravan in my garden. I said, hey, I live at 478.
Fair play for starting by you then.
Yeah, listen, she was impressed. At least I kept it tidy inside, mate. But that was it. But I used to drive past that arena and think, fucking hell, one day, like my little bad car, fucking car constantly on empty fuel. But I had that vision, I had that dream that one day I will fight there, one day I'll make it happen. And fucking all of a sudden, for 3 years into my career, it's about to happen. All the hardships, I'm about to achieve the fucking goal I first set out to do. You know, graduated from university and I'm fucking doing all right in my job. And now, fucking hell, I'm about to fight for a British title. Now, I'm running 5 weeks' time against a fella called Martin Lindsay. Now, I'd watched Martin Lindsay been in some terrific fights. I'd watch him knock the likes of Denny Matthews out with left hooks, fucking spin him around, and they're going to sleep on way down. Thinking, fuck, this is going to be a tough fight. Other fighters around that time were your likes of John Simpson, Martin Lindsay, and there was Lee Selby. They were, you know, the big names at the time. And Lee Selby had the British title, and I think he'd moved on to European level. And I got Martin Lindsay. Absolutely shitting myself before all that one, because that was the fucking goal, the Lord Lonsdale belt. You know, one of the oldest prizes in British sport. You know, never mind fucking Wimbledon and FA Cups. That was one of the oldest, you know, pugilistic, fucking brilliant belt, beautiful belt. I remember seeing one of the lads as a young lad on my third fight Gary Sykes had won it down in Huddersfield. I remember him coming back to the change room, was fucking over his shoulder and looking at him, he could have been a god right there, all around him, fucking hell. And I thought, wow, that's all I want to do. I want to have that feeling, what he's feeling right there. I want to be a British champion. Crazy show that, actually. On that show, though, me, Carl Frampton, Tyson Fury, and Gary Sykes, Tyrone Nurse, all boxing on that same card. Yeah. Who would have fucking known that we all get to the stages we're at now? Yeah. But anyway, that's where we were at. Nervous as fuck for that one, because I thought, that's my goal.
Did you ever get nervous before fights?
Yeah. Listen, always, just because I realised what could happen, you know, Wisehead, like I say, Wisehead on young shoulders. I know that one punch could change fight. I know that people put your life on the line. I know that people get knocked out in one punch. These were serious fighters now. We weren't fucking... I was maturing. I was 23, 22 years old. No, 21 year old, 22. Around that early 20s
still
anyway.
Still young.
Still young, mate. Still young. And I'm going to these fights again. These are men. These are fucking solid men. Like I say, there's some lads I went to school with. They had beers at 15. Fucking I talk like a little girl. We've watched him drop until they're like fucking 17 or something. So, you know, I would have boy fighting these men. These tough, tough men. And fucking nervous as fuck. I had like 3,000 there. It was Wednesday night. Sky Show headlining it. And I remember even the missus and Mrs. Mum and Dad saying to me, "We'll see you when you get home. Looking forward to seeing that belt, Josh. Enjoy yourself." I'm thinking to myself, they're thinking it's a fucking given. They think it's a given. I've still got a man in the opposite corner there who is going to try to take my head off, and I've still got to go in there and be switched on and deliver a good performance to come home with that belt. I've still got to fight in front. I've still got 12 hard rounds in there. I remember listening to a radio interview. Eddie Earn were live from down at the Leeds Arena at that time, and he's saying, listen, there's a lot of pressure on Josh's shoulders right now. He's got to come through this. And if he doesn't, you know, he's going to get embarrassed in front of all his fans. They're like, fucking, at least someone's recognising that I've got a tough fight in my hands. And it was a tough, tough fight. I don't know, it's because I'd only boxed 5 weeks beforehand. I went straight into the training camp and I got on with it. Martin was just a tough, tough man. Like, hitting him was like fucking punching that wall. It was just solid. And when he hit me, I felt like his shots were solid. He's the only man in 30 fights that was really, really hurt me. He caught me with fifth round with a body shot. And I thought, fucking good shot that. Then he caught me again with another good shot. With same place, about fucking 10 seconds later. Mm-hmm. And it completely took the wind out of my sails. Now, I've watched it back and I don't look as hurt as what I fucking felt, but inside, mate, fucking hell, I'm gasping for breath. Anyone who's ever been winded, it's not a nice feeling. Never mind doing it in front of thousands of people with pressure of fucking someone who just wants to hurt you. Fifth round, I'm still moving about. I've recovered a little bit because I'm, you know, always had a good fitness. Bang, he's got me again with about 10 seconds to go. I've gone back to the stool, sat down. My dad's pulled my gum shield. He went, "How are you feeling, lad?" I went, "Fuck, dad, fucked." He said, "Listen, you need to change this up, mate, because otherwise you're going to fucking put it on you now." But he gave me a bit of instruction. He said, "You've got to pinpoint his body." Gets up at 6th round. Bang, I catch him early. Hurts him to body. Changes course at fight. But fucking hell, after the fight, it was the first time that I pissed blood after the fight. It was like a pint of Guinness. I'll show you pictures after. I'll show you pictures after. But yeah, okay. You know, it's not a fucking tickling competition. You've got internal organs. You know, around all these sensitive organs around your body, you know, all around this area, around your ribcage, all protected and stuff. And listen, you fucking, like I say, it's not a tickling competition. Mm-hmm. We've got them 8 ounce gloves on. The fuck all, really. You know, people probably want to find out their 8 ounce gloves, fuck all in it. And for 12 rounds, you're battling fuck out of each other. It's going to leave a bit of a mark. And but yeah, I'd done it. The British champion, it didn't fucking matter. Oh, mate. Champion of world, fucking hell. Unbelievable feeling. I mean, bumping at some of my pals outside Leeds Arena, fucking hell. All pissed up, done it, Josh, blah, 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 what fucking. At the time, Leeds United weren't doing too clever. So a lot of football lads who I've met, who'd followed me, who liked the boxing as well. Outside people would call them casuals, but just because fucking they didn't have no one to follow from Leeds, they've never made the presence or whatever. Now they've got someone of their own city. They're following him. So he's hard on. Josh Warrington's hard on. Leeds United doing shit. But fucking, and we're behind Josh now. He's giving us good glory days and that. So yeah, fucking absolutely buzzing. I'm an hero to a lot of people there and then. Fucking, I've seen some fights that were fantastic, Josh. I'm starting getting a bit of money behind me, so I can go get myself an house deposit in that same time. I go down to match room and I sign my first contract with Eddie. The fight with Lee Selby is starting to build from early on. It's 2014. We were there at a match room barbecue. Like the likes of AJ, Kel Brook, Kevin Mitchell, Darren Bark were all there at the time.
Cream of the crop.
All the big names, yeah. Now fucking I'm coming down there and Lee Selby were there, sat with there with fucking all Gucci gear on, fucking shirt and all that. And Sky had us go like do a little bit of an head to head. And they said, "Oh, will you have a face up?" And they went, like, "Ah, fucking having a face up." I didn't feel like we had no animosity back then. Do you know what I mean? But they planted the seed there. I think Eddie had wanted us to fight at some stage down the line, and that's when all that started to build up.
So that took 4 years to get that fight.
That took 4 years. It took 4 years.
What happened with Eddie? And then you left Eddie to go with Frank Warren.
Yeah. So what had happened from there is, you know, fucking I'm British champion now. You win British title, you have 3 defences and you get to keep that for life. I mean, the belt's worth about 15, 16 grand as itself. So I thought, fucking hell, when the days ever happen, when I'm old and retired, then I can flog that. But yeah, listen, they're handcrafted. Not one of them is the same. So that was my goal. I'll fucking win it out right now, you know. Mm-hmm. I've won it now, but I've gone back to change rooms and that's it. I never felt, I've done it, I've ticked a box and I'm fucking buzzing and, you know, people are talking about you in good ways, but I didn't feel satisfied, James, you know what I mean? Like, what else is next? Next minute, I get a shot at the European. Knocks that guy out. All of a sudden, I've gone from fighting in fucking small old leisure centre shows, like going about Leeds in my little car after work, fucking after training on my days off, going round to pubs, my pals' houses, selling tickets. All of a sudden, I'm doing fucking interviews with all these big media companies, you know, newspapers I never fucking even heard of. You know, I've gone from like small old little tiny articles in Yorkshire Evening Post and 5 minutes on local radio station to likes of Talk Sport and, like I say, these massive broadsheets. And I'm still working as a dental technician at these days. I mean, after winning European, I remember going back to work on the following Monday and fucking delivery drivers are bringing materials to lab. "Hey, I'm sure I've seen your face before. Where have I seen you? I tell you, you look like that boxer who boxed on Weekend." "Oh, yeah, that was me." "Fuck off, that wasn't you." He said, "No, what are you doing here?" I was like, "This is my day job." "Ah, fuck off, you must be a millionaire." And a few of my pals used to say, "It's a mad sport, is boxing. You fucking headlining shows on a Saturday night." But a lot of fucking, you know, it's probably only people who were featured on that channel who probably can't even afford the Sky subscription. You know, you see people on TV and everyone instantly thinks that you're a fucking millionaire, which is far from it. It was far from it, you know. And I was starting to do all right, but I wasn't enough to quit work and everything else. So I was still working.
So you were winning British, European.
I'm Commonwealth
that?
British and European champion. You know, and I'm,
who
I mean,
the fuck's that, Josh?
I fucking hell, mate. Just, again, why is that on young shoulders? Realising that...
Is that because you didn't, you still wanted something to fall back on?
Yes.
Completely, that you didn't just go full steam ahead? Was that not even more tiring, though, having to go to work and train?
Not only that, I'd been wise to people around us. I'd seen other lads get to my stage, earn some good paydays.
Other boxers?
Yeah, who should have more or less paid the mortgage off, have a nice car and drive, but have spunked it up on, you know, a fancy watch, some nice holidays, treating all pals out on a night out, and all of a sudden they've got a pot to piss in. They've lost one fight. All of a sudden, fucking hell, they're struggling to get in title fights again. You know, it's one of them things. Is boxing where one fight going the wrong way, especially in the early stages of your career, can change you. Now, when I were coming through as a pro, Eddie was just starting to make waves. He wasn't as big as what he is now. Obviously, Matchroom's always been about because we're Barry Earn, but you had your promoters with likes of Frank Maloney, now Kelly Maloney. Mm-hmm. Frank Warren were doing little bits and bats with Satanta and other channels, but it wasn't as big as what it is now. You know, I'll fight on some shows with leisure centres and you'd have like a British title as the main event, and then further down the line would just be like a chief support. Now you fucking... boxing fans are spoiled. You've got like world title fights, multiple British title fights on undercard, and fucking all these names. Mm-hmm. And like the money wasn't as good as what it is now. You know, sponsors weren't as involved as what they are now. Now you've got household names as sponsors fucking getting involved with boxing. you didn't have that back then when and that was only like 5-6 years ago, James, you know what I mean? But and I always used to think like, I don't want to fucking quit my job and you know, get beat in a fight and then fucking hell, you know.
Is that always at the back of your mind?
That's it, yeah. And I think another thing as well, it took me mind off things. I wasn't constantly boxing. I just go back to the job and I just had a focus. You know, I just had a focus. But then from that European stage, 2014, 2015, things went very, very quickly. And I wasn't prepared for how quickly they went. Again, all of a sudden, like I say, you know, odd person's recognising me in the street to now I'm going to the local supermarket and fucking everyone's recognising me. People are recognising me on social media. People are talking to me, people I don't know. I'm having to fucking say to Gaffer, hey, can I have 5 minutes? BBC Five Live want to speak to me, you know what I mean? And it's crazy. Yeah. And then I've gone from having maybe 500 people watching me in a leisure centre, then fucking 700 people watching me in Leeds Town Hall, to I'm boxing Leeds Arena, fucking I've got 10,000 there, Vinnie Jones is doing ring walk behind me, fucking I'm the next Ricky Hatton, you know, within like 12 months, Josh Warrington's British, European, Commonwealth champion, he's making waves, he's the most exciting, one of the biggest prospects to run away with. And that was it. Fucking everything just like fast forward. And like I say, I wasn't prepared for it. And I'd fight against a fella called Dennis Tabeiron. It was WBC international fight title. Walked out there. Far too giddy for what it was. I kind of started to believe my own hype. Fucking
lose focus a bit.
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit. I was doing so much media. I would try to respond to everybody on social media on my phone. I would argue with folk because, you know, fucking all of a sudden...
Yeah, the ego gets
people are patting your back. Like, when I got to Rendell, like, stage when I'm fighting Rendell, people are patting your back. Nice one, Josh, well done, fucking. As soon as you start getting to a stage where he's becoming a big name nationwide, who the fuck is only there in that position because if it's a fucking ticket seller. If you want a ticket seller, then he wouldn't be in that position. They don't know that... Where the career's been beforehand, and you know,
jumping up to the coattails, they've not seen the full journey.
Yeah, exactly. You know, yeah, I can't punch, oh, it's fucking shit, blah blah blah. So I'm there, fucking spending my time arguing with all these people, and I'm wanting to prove all these people that, you know, I am that person. I can be that big person, and I've got this guy in front of me, Filipino Dennis Tabeiron, and I've gone out there, and game plan's gone completely out the window for first four round. I'm just fucking chasing him around ring, like a psycho, just trying to throw big punches. Now, my last three fights, and I'd stopped Rendell Monroe, I beat Martin Lindsay, I'd knocked out Fellafoot European title David Dielli, I went up to Berlin, I stopped a fella in five rounds, so I'm thinking, I'm on a fucking right roll here, I'm starting to really get my man strength, right, really starting to sit on my punches, always knowing that I could have a bit of a scrap in the gym, because as an amateur, throughout my early pro career, I used to spar with likes of British champions and lads who were higher level than me. Fucking hell, I spent my 21st birthday in a 12-foot ring sparring with Carl Johansson, who was super featherweight champion, who had a devastating knockout power. Boxer likes of Ricky Burns, beat Ricky Burns, had him on his backside a fair few times, Michael Gomez. So I'd mixed with these Rollers. Decent caliber of people. I knew I wasn't made out fucking out of glass. So I knew I could... I knew I could stand and fight when I needed to, but it was about bringing it to the table. Like I said to you earlier, I knew that one punch could change a fight. So my thinking always used to be, just win the fight. And then, obviously, as you win the fight, it opens doors to other things. I was seeing my pay packet getting bigger, my profile getting bigger. So just win the fight. If you're doing all right, just win it. Just see it out. But because of all this hype what was going on around me, I just fucking wanted to smash it. So I'm chasing this geezer around ring, bang. By about halfway through... I'm pissing the fight. I'm up on everybody's cards, on the judge's cards, but he don't want to know. He just wants to see final bell. I'm exhausted fucking physically and mentally because I'm fucking frustrated because he's just backpedaling. He's not trying to engage in a fight. He's not trying to win it. He just wants to see final bell. And I'm running forward fucking wild, but it's taking a lot of it out of me because I'm not setting up punches. I'm not setting out knockout punches. I'm just fucking putting absolute everything to every punch. By 12th round, I've won fight. Fucking on all judges' scorecards, but I'm fucked. I'm absolutely fucked. And then I get roasted on social media, absolutely roasted by pundits, by Silent Ring. Josh Warrington wants to be in world level. Not on that performance. He needs to do a lot better. I just don't think he's got it. Don't think he'd get there. And I think the next few fights will be there'll be Sean, and all of a sudden, fucking hell, James, I didn't know how to deal with that. Like you said before, and I'm not media trained. You know, I don't fucking know how to talk to these people and how to respond to that. How are you doing these interviews? Do you think you found your limit, Josh? What the fuck do you say to that? No, I've just had a bad day at office, and they're trying to catch you out in certain interviews. All of a sudden, I'm fucking going back to my hotel room and fucking, Josh, what a cunt he is, fucking embarrassment, that was shite, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I can't fucking handle all this shit. Mm-hmm. No, I'm used to people coming up to you in the street and like, if they call you a cunt, you're like, fucking what, mate? Yeah. All of a sudden, you've got people you've never met in your life calling you this, that, and other, so you're responding. And that, fucking, I couldn't handle it. So I've took myself away, went on holiday, me and Mrs. had a nice holiday. I've come back, I'm thinking it's all been forgot about. Anytime I put a tweet out or a post out, it's still there, bam, people are hammering me. You think, fucking hell. Now, you know, in this day and age, social media is fucking, to those older listeners, I would probably think, what's it all about? You could just ignore it. But social media is a big platform, certainly to speaking to your fans and to promoting yourself. So you can't help not see that. You used to read that a lot, and I remember thinking, fucking hell. So I went over to, my manager started a meeting out with Ricky Atten, and we sat down with Ricky. I'm like, fucking hell, Rick, you were similar to myself, you know, come through fucking small halls and all that. You built a big following. How did you cope with fucking all the pressure of, you know, critics and that? He said, listen, it was a little bit different from my day. He said, you know, we just had the papers and journals, and you'd be able to speak to them just on phone. But he said, listen, I still get it now. So I was a bit surprised by that. He said, I said, what do you mean, Ricky? He said, fucking hell, you're an household legend. How do you still get, you know, shit on social media? Everyone loves you. He said, listen, Josh, it gets the fucking centre free. I might put a tweet out about Man City. He says, people turn around and say to me, you fucking should have slit your fist, your wrist while you had a chat, your fans, you fat bastard. He says, I always get it, you know, fucking people up and down. He says, but why the fuck do you give, why do you give so much attention, and why do you give a fuck about what Dave, the fucking Sparky, says, who can't get a fuck off his missus, who ain't done anything in his life? Why are you getting worked up about that? And I kind of thought, I started looking at that from a different light, like, he's right. Why am I getting so worked up about these fucking people? And I kind of just started working up from there, building a bit of a thicker skin, seeing it for what it is, just their, you know, fucking messages on a screen. And the next few fights, I'd worked on really keeping my concentration, and I pulled out some very, very big performances from there, Joe Brunkner, which we're really proud about, because people were saying after that performance against Tilbron, Brunkner's going to walk through him. It's fucking, and these were fights, what were like fringe world title fights. After that, I had a fighter called Isashi Yamagasa. He was ranked like top three in all world governing bodies at the time, and had a good win against him. And the fight against Lee Selby was really starting to build up from there on.
Yeah, because I know that was 2018, that was fight of the year.
Yes.
Why did it take so long from the 2014 to the 2018?
Because we was going to go ahead in 2016 with Eddie, as now I'd come out of ring against Isashi Yamagasa, and Eddie were like, right, I want to make this happen. Of course, things had gone on very, very quickly. British, Commonwealth, European. It was as though everyone expected, like, a lot. So it was like, fucking, we don't want to be messing about with these fringe level world titles. We want to go straight into this fight with Lee Selby. The rivalry had started happening. People started talking a lot on Twitter about the fight happening, what, you know, playing out scenarios and things. Me and him had a little bit of thing on social media, like, he went analysing fucking Isashi Yamagasa fight. And he was saying, listen, I could write on back of a fucking postage stamp. What Josh Warrington could do, you know, blah, blah, blah. So do a little bit of needle stepping in from there. Now, Eddie'd put an offer to us, and around the time, I'd had a date to get married. And me and my old fella sat down, and he said, listen, I need your fucking head on this 100%, lad. He said, what do you think? I said, Dad, fucking, let's see it, world title, let's have it. He said, fucking, I need your head completely on this one. He said, you're not going to get being distracted. I said, listen, ideally, you know, fucking, it'd be all right if we could move the date. So if we can change the date, then that'd be better. But if not, then fucking, we go ahead. It's just a go. We head forward there. So my dad's phone, my manager, Steve. Steve spoke with Eddie. Next minute, I'm in fucking garden at home, cutting my grass. Fucking phone's going mental in my pocket. Lads, that fucking go stick Sky Sports News on Josh. I've run in. Fucking put Sky Sports on. In other news, boxing now, when Josh Warrington has rejected the fight with Lee Selby. He's turned down the fight. An offer was made by promoter Eddie Hearn. And I'm thinking, fuck me, what's all this about? So I'm ringing Steve. Steve, fucking hell, have you seen Sky Sports News? Yeah, I'm trying to get hold of Eddie now. They'd put it to Selby. Selby had said, no, he fucking... It's been offered that opportunity. If he don't want it, then fuck it, he's not having it. That would it. All of a sudden, it's been leaked to news that I don't want the fight. So I think, fucking hell. And I'm getting stick on social media, getting your fucking bottle job, you don't want it. and it was all... We went back with Eddie and said, can you try and negotiate it for the end of the year? He tried negotiating it. This was like in June time. He tried negotiating it for like October, November. And then it carried on. And not what happening. And he couldn't get out, like, couldn't seem to get a deal with Selby. So we come to end of our contract as well. And my dad had been speaking to Frank Warren, and he just signed a contract with BT. Now, I didn't want to change, to be honest with you, because I was happy with where I was at. And I knew that Eddie might be able to get something. But Frank was offering good money, and he was saying, listen, well, I'll make sure that happens. I'll do everything I can to make that happen. So in that time, it gave me a bit of time out the ring. I had like an added operation on my elbow that I needed doing.
How did that affect you being 11 months out?
You know what? It's probably a blessing in disguise, James, because I needed it. I'd been fucking boxing non-stop with like most of like 2 or 3 weeks off in between. I'd go and have a pint with my pals like 2 or 3 weeks after, but after that, I'd want to be back in gym. Mm-hmm. So it was probably the longest time I had off. And if anything, fucking hell, I matured properly as into a man, you know what I mean? And like really come into my shape and everything there. And it was good. It was a rest I needed. Like I say, I got an elbow operation as well. So I'm 25 at the time. I signed with Frank Warren. He's just signed with BT. So things are starting to move. I come straight into the fight with Kiko Martinez. Tough fight, but they were trying to get me to fight a bit of a steady fight. Now, I didn't want that. I'm thinking, if we're going to fight fucking Lee Selby, can't be going into steady fights where I'm blowing someone out of water. Yeah. I need to have a real, real tough fight. So Kiko Martinez, 11 month out, straight in with him, former world champion. And he went on to win a European title and fight for a world title again after me. Tough fight. Straight back in, perforated my eardrums, bruised my ribs. I'd fucking busted my hand in 3 rounds with that. But I got through it. Then I had a final eliminator against Dennis Salan. And I won that, fucking nervous as fuck before that one. Probably the most nervous I've been before a fight, because I'd been saying for a long, long time, James, that I'm going to win world title. I'm going to win world title. Since Eddie started building it up, since the talk of me and Lee going together, that's when I started to believe it. That's when I started to see it. Like before, I used to say, I'm going to win British. I'm going to fight at Leeds Arena. That way I'd set out the fucking goal of fighting for world title. Eddie had started building up this thing, it's going to be at Ellen Road, because my fan base were getting bigger and bigger every time, and the people were starting to stop me in the street, when you're fighting at Ellen Road, little old ladies, when you're fighting at Ellen Road, is it going to happen? Oh, we're having that Ellen Road one. Well, I'm fighting at Arena soon. Ah, fuck that one, we'll come to one at Ellen Road when it happens. So people were all excited for it. It was happening for a long, long time, and this were eliminator, so win that one, I'm in a fucking solid spot there. I'm ranked number one and the fight's going to happen. But at the same time, my missus were pregnant and I just felt like, fucking hell, I lose this fight and I'm going to be the nearly man. The man who almost boxed for a world title, the man who did everything but gets that hurdle of a fight for a world title and it don't happen. But yeah, probably fucking nervous I'd been. And for 5 rounds, my legs were like jelly. Fucking, I just couldn't keep my composure, and then settled into it and knocked him out in 10th round. Mm. And that was it then. I felt like everything I've ever done up to my career had come to that moment, that next fight. And it was a case of, now, that's the ultimate bauble. Fucking hell, a world title fight. I never thought when I first started that I'd ever win a world title. Fucking British title with a goal, European, international titles after that were a bonus. All of a sudden, fighting for fucking biggest bauble in the fucking world, man. Unbelievable world title. Like, it's like 4 years before that, my missus bought me tickets to go watch Foch Groves, won. the first one in Manchester Arena, and I remember looking about thinking, wow, fucking hell, I'd love to be in a big occasion like this. And all of a sudden I'm having my own big occasion at a football stadium at Elland Road. Never good enough to play football, but that was my time to fucking walk out the tunnel at Elland Road.
When did you get told it was going to be at Elland Road?
Well, Eddie had started to build it up.
So Eddie was back again?
This was before the first one. He'd started to build it up, and then Frank had said, I'm going to make it happen. And it nearly didn't. It nearly didn't, because negotiations were taking a long time to get over the road, and me and my manager Steve were heading down to London. And I had a fucking... this was start of 2018. I had a message come through from one of the media team from Frank's office, and he said, this is artwork for poster. And it said fucking, it was the same date, but Leeds Arena. And I replied back to him saying, fucking, we're going back down to speak to Frank now to try and negotiate this. Just don't put that out, just hold out for an hour or so. So Frank had obviously given green light to just, fuck it, we're going to go to Arena. We can't make a deal with Elland Road. We go down, had a meeting with Frank. And people from our side had a meeting with Leeds, and we managed to get over the line, but it nearly didn't happen. You know, it nearly didn't happen. But
was Selby okay to agree to go to Elland Road?
He didn't mind, because he got the A side of the coin. He got the A side of the pay packet. And to be honest with you, it was the biggest platform that he got to box on, because he wanted a massive ticket seller. He didn't have a big profile. So, you know, to fight in an outdoor stadium, even if you are in the away corner, and the crowd are against you, it's still something to put on your CV, and it's an unbelievable accolade to do. Not everybody gets to do it. How was that feeling
then? Because obviously when we're speaking now, it's like you doubt yourself before your fights, even though British champion, Commonwealth champion, European champion, and now going for a world title, undefeated as well. Do you think that helps you when you think, okay, I'm underdog here? Because before the Selby fight, you were a massive underdog.
Massive underdog.
Even though... all the fights, some class fights that you'd been in, some fucking tough old slogs.
Mm.
Why were you so underrated getting into that fight, undefeated?
Because, again, a lot of people have just seen me as a ticket seller. You know, I'm not only in that position. They take away everything that we've achieved so far. They took away English, British, Commonwealth, International. And because my knockout ratio wasn't too good, they took away the names who I'd beat. They're like, you know, a fucking... fringe level world opponents, fellas who could have boxed for world titles in their own right, and no one would have argued against that. They could have boxed for a world title and just didn't get the shot. It's Isashi Amagasa, who were boxed in 2016. Their manager had pleaded with Eddie, let us fight Lee Selby. It's like, no, beat Josh and you can fight him. In his own right, he should have been there, because he was ranked, like I say, top three in all world governing bodies. I beat him, and I never seemed to get the credit. Well, that's because I'm associated with Leeds United or whatever, and so many people don't like Leeds. I don't know. Maybe because I don't fucking talk as much shit or whatever. Yeah. I don't know.
Do you just let your boxing do the talking?
The boxing do the talking. Mm-hmm. I'm only starting to realise now that, you know, it is a show. People
it's
fucking...
entertainment as well, isn't it?
Yeah, people do like a, you know, a slagging off at fucking... press conferences, people don't like people chucking tables.
I don't think you should ever change tables. Look how far you've got to being just you.
I think I could sleep at night, being honest. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? I was like, I've always realised what goes into this game. I've been round the box in a long time. I know that fucking, that's your, lads who have grown up in the 70s and 80s when they have a scrap on the street and they used to be at a shake hand, that's our way of doing it. That's where we're sorting out business. So yeah, you can say whatever beforehand, but I've got to be true to myself, because the pals know me. And most of the people who are in stands who've had a conversation with me know that I'm half all right to speak to. I had a cunt, so then I'm turning up to a press conference acting like a wanker. Mm-hmm. Like, well, what's Josh about? He's changed, you know what I mean? So yeah. I was being true to myself as well. But yeah, the biggest fight of my career. And the reason I would always have that, I wouldn't say a bit of doubt, just a bit of uncertainty. I wouldn't go in too confident. I always realise that fucking things could happen, you know, that, and that's in any way of life. I think you've got to be prepared for, you know, fallback. You've got to be prepared for setback in businesses or in sport. You know, if fucking things don't go right, then don't worry about it. Now, what I mean by that is, all right, I've got a perfect record, unblemished, but there's some hard fights I've had to go through, really fucking dig deep in the mill. There's, like I say, there's times when I've come back to change rooms, I'm fucking trembling, perforated ears, sore ribs, sore hands, fucking pissing blood. You know, people don't say that. There's been times, sparring sessions, my last sparring session before the fight, and I've got my ass handed to me in gym, fucking battered from pull at a post by some novice fighter. And I'm thinking to myself, fuck me, I'm fighting in front of 10,000 people next week and I've just been battered by this fucking novice here. Mm-hmm. What's wrong with me? But it matters for the night. It matters for that one night, and that was it. It's like when I was building up to that fight, I'd been talking about it for so long and I believed I could beat him for so long. Everyone else doubted me. I'd visualised it for so long. Visualising something that I'd done for a very, very long time, and I didn't realise it was actually a thing until fucking, mate, all that shit, I'm into all that stuff, but I didn't realise that was a thing, and I'd been doing that since I was a kid.
So just manifesting everything.
Just, my dad, well, it started off from my dad. My dad used to take me out to leisure centres when I was in championships at shows and stuff, and, you know, say for instance I were boxing up in Newcastle or boxing in Liverpool or boxing down in London. We drive all the way down there to fucking book an hotel. Now I used to think to myself, fucking get in Yellow Pages, pick phone up and fucking call them and go book an hotel room like that way. Right, no, we'll go for a ride. We'll just go for a drive. I want to get the route familiar. So, right, okay, whatever, dad, fucking hell. So we go along, we get along to this hotel and then we go to a venue, wherever it was. 9 times out of 10, it'd be in a leisure centre, fucking, South Shields Leisure Centre, fucking Olympia in Liverpool, venues like that. Then my dad's got a gift at Gab. So it'd be like, we turn up. Hey up, love. Boxing here next week. Can I just have a quick look round and that? So next minute, I'd be looking round, fucking hell. Yeah, I reckon, Josh, this is where ring's going to be. You're going to be down here. Yeah. Do you know where change rooms are going to be, love? Yeah, well, let's go have a little look. So he went, hey, just you get yourself familiar with it. That's it. Just don't feel alien to you. And then I'd go home that week and I'd be fucking thinking about it in Bath, thinking about it when I'm going for a run. I could picture what the venue would look like. Yeah. And I didn't realise that was a thing until later on. Then fucking when I'm building up my career, I'd picture fighting at Leeds Arena. I'd picture fucking people walking up to it thinking, fucking hell, we're going to watch that Josh Warrington tonight. Picture them being in pubs, you know, before and having a pint beforehand, then walking up to the arena. And then all of a sudden it were there. I used to go with my pals, fucking sat in stands every now and again. And since it'd been talked about from like 2016, sat there just like watching the game and I think going off in a little tangent of my own thinking, fucking hell, imagine I'd fighting there. And people would go for a piss at half time and people, hey, you'd be fighting here soon, won't you, Josh? Mm-hmm. Is it happening or what? Is it happening? And, you know, I'd get adrenaline rush thinking about it then because they're all excited about it. And then I think to myself, fucking hell, how would it be? I know, how would it look with a ring in the middle of the ring? The last time they were a fight there were like 1992. Henry Wharton had boxed. They'd never been a Leeds world champion. Fucking, I could make history for City. I'd be able to walk out to fucking thousands of people. What an event it'd be. And then I'd play scenarios, how I'd win the fight, how fucking things would happen, would I get knocked down, would I get cut? I'd prepared for all these different scenarios, but nobody else outside, a small group of people from Leeds and some of my best pals, nobody else could see it. Josh is all right, but I haven't got punch power. He's just got that engine. Mm-hmm. Leeds going to fucking box his head off. I remember doing an article, only finding out after the fight that a journo had phoned me up and he'd asked 80 other boxing pundits and fighters and trainers who they thought were going to win. And then when they published the column before the fight, it was 7-6 to Lee Selby. But he'd asked 80 people and only fucking 6 people out of them 80 people had picked me. Okay. Everyone else were fucking picking Selby. And like I say, I was 4-1. Mm-hmm. 4-1 in a fucking 2-horse race. Like, I'd not done anything wrong, James. I'd only beaten everyone in front of me. I'd beaten people with unbeaten records, but I was still getting tarnished. That, now he's going to get this is where the fucking hype bubble got, you know, gets found out. And to be fair, I probably most relaxed I'd been before the fight. I was here at this hotel and I had my pals with me, and normally I stay in here fucking like a bit of a weirdo, like, this is it, fucking I'm prepared to die in the ring, you know, it's all about just getting that win. All about getting the double. I don't care if they're fucking pulling me out on a stretcher, as long as I've got that fucking arm raised at end of the fight, that's all that matters to me. Obsessed with winning. And I remember being in here and like some of my pals, I met him for a coke outside. Not a line of coke, just a Coca-Cola. And
getting me excited there.
And some of my pals sat there saying, hey Josh, it's fucking buzzing in Leeds, mate. Mm-hmm. It's fucking buzzing. He says, listen, no matter whatever happens tonight, mate, fucking hell. Tell you what, people remember this. There's already a buzzing fucking in town now, mate. Fucking everyone's talking about it. Every bar is bouncing. And it kind of made me feel like I want the boxer. I was the one fucking going to watch it. Like, I was one of them. I was getting excited as well. Fine. So like, fucking hell, look forward. So I want nervous no more. I'm excited. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I remember driving down, one of my pals like, fucking hell, me and him talking about the times when we were fucking running down Beeston Hill to watch games at Elland Road, fucking being in my overdraft, you know, getting a ticket to watch Leeds United and watching some of the games, frustrated, thinking, why the fuck aren't they giving their all? You know, we've paid our hard earned money here to fucking watch them, and they can't be arsed, man. So I'm going to give absolutely everything here, and driving past it thinking, fuck me, wow, look at all this. Thousands and thousands of people are here to watch basically myself fighting and all turn up and, you know, fucking excited. They were in there with me and fucking hell. Walked into that stadium that night, I felt like a god, mate. I felt like an absolute god. I'd been there the night before. I'd visualised it. I'd been in the ring. I got on my fucking hands and knees. A picture on my Instagram where I've done it. I've got to come out of ring war, tunnel. I've walked at ring, got in ring, fucking shadow boxed, you know, played scenarios out, and I've fell on my knees fucking many a times. And then I kept on singing it again. And then who? And then who? Probably fucking fellas who were sitting at ring thinking, weird bastard, what is he doing? But I'm getting myself ready for that. You know, just seeing it. 24 hours later, with air pulling up, gets into the stadium, massive buzz as I've got off at bus, walk into the change rooms and, you know, you sat there, there's messages over the football, you know, side before self every time. And I thought to myself, there's no fucking way I'm losing tonight. There's no way. And walk into the ring. Even before that, in change rooms, normally I get myself worked up. It's like I sit down there and it's like, there we go. Fucking hell, this is everything you've worked hard to, everything you've sacrificed, every punch you've taken, every black eye. It all comes down to this fucking moment. How bad has he won it? How bad is he prepared to go through that? Is he really willing to fucking go through the pain barrier like I am? I'm going to fucking make sure I keep on throwing them punches until my arms fucking hurt. This is it. I'm willing to die in the ring, get myself really psyched up. But I'm sat there and I start talking to myself like I always do. And the nerves won't, the adrenaline won't pump in as like it normally does. I'm thinking, what the fuck's wrong with me here? But it all come to this moment. It was a case of, this is where I show everything what I'm about. There's no point in just like, oh, I just win the fight. It's like, give absolutely everything. Gets the call. Right, here we go. Here we go. You ready, Josh? Fucking hell, stand on my knees. Let's go, boys. Fucking walk to the ring. People around me, fucking hell. This is it, Josh, now. This, my dad's like, fucking here. Proud of your son. Proud of your pal. We stood at door. Fucking 25,000 fucking people out there on my own. You know, some of them I'll never meet, you know, I might not meet again in my life. Some of them, you know, I know very, very well. I've got my fucking boy Odeiro and Lucas Radebe fucking doing ring walk with us. Fucking Kaiser Chiefs are playing us out live. I predict a riot because I walk out to I predict a riot. This is all fucking goosebump moments, but I'm probably the coolest I've ever been in my career. Could have put a heart rate monitor on me and I was just fucking, I might as well have been dead. You know what I mean? I've walked.
Why was that then?
Unbelievable. My old fella said to me, listen, take this in, because I realise that these things don't come about that often. Gets in the ring, looking over to Cop, like I say, I'm looking down at people ringside, they're fucking there with me, they're like, come on, Josh. Heart's fucking pounding, you can see their heart pounding from their chest. You know, they've been telling everyone who'd listen, Josh is going to fucking do that. They've got the fucking their month's wage on me winning as well, you know. People are there with me ringside, you know what I mean?
It's like, quid that night.
Oh, most definitely. There's a lot of people who've done very well on that night. I'm looking over to the crowd, I'm thinking people are nervous for me, looking down ringside. I'm looking down at my missus, she's fucking probably the most nervous she's ever been. I've told her that it's going to be a tough fight and there might be stages where it looks like I'm in a difficult position, but don't worry, I'll bring someone to the table, what I've never brought before, excuse me. And then I've kind of taken it all in. My dad says, listen, as soon as he fucking gets in the ring, you switch on. And that's what I did. As soon as he walked into the ring, bam, that was it. All splinkers were on. Fucking, we might
you
have
came
been,
out flying.
Mate, we might as well have been in a fucking phone box right there.
When was the head cut? When did that, the head bang?
That would in a few rounds in. That
were you worried that it could have been stopped?
Never. It just is what it is. It's just part of the fight. It was just part of the fight. But, you know, he gets in the ring. Now, everyone had talked about how big a featherweight he is, how he fucking balloons up. And I remember him taking his gown off. I thought, fucking hell, is this it? You know what I mean? I'd been sparring fucking like welters and light middles prior to him. So I'm having real, real tough sparring sessions. And when he got in, same weight as me, thinking, listen, fucking hell, he's no big monster though, everyone says he is. I'd also had a bit of a chat with Billy Graham, Ricky Hatton's old trainer. Me and my old fella had gone on for asking him a bit of advice because these were kind of similar fights, like when he boxed, Ricky Hatton boxed Costa Zhu. It was a bit of a defining fight. And Billy recalls a time when he walked into Manchester Arena, 20,000 people out, with 4 o'clock in the morning for the American TV, and people were like, good luck tonight, Billy. As though it was fucking, it was gonna, that was the final night, you know what I mean? And like, everyone was saying to us, fucking, good luck, like, we weren't gonna win it, we were massive underdogs. Walked in the changing room, Ricky were fucking shadowboxing away, and like, I could see that he was fucking up for it.
He wanted that.
And when we walked at ringing, Blue Moon fucking rung out. He said, fucking, and we felt like fucking God's there. And I said to Ricky, as soon as we get in there, you fucking get to him, and you show him who's fucking boss, you show him who's in this fight tonight. I want you to show him about fight. And I kind of remembered that, and my dad had said to me, listen, no fucking daft, but you've got to put your stamp on him in this first fucking round. So we goes out, Lee's like fucking likes a bit of distance. And I'm getting there. Normally in the first round, you get an idea of someone's punch power, someone's strength. I've come forward, he's thrown a right hand, caught it on my gloves, but instantly get an idea. This isn't the fucking toughest puncher I've been in with. We've come in at a clinch. I fucking had a bit of a wrestle with him. Realise that he can't wrestle back. Well, he's not fucking that strong either. Then I've caught him with a few of my own. I'm feinting shots and I'm making him react. I'm thinking to myself, this is my fight. I go back to corner, fucking buzzing, sit down. And I was like, listen, silly cunt, calm yourself down, because my dad's always been, he's always had a way of words. He's always like, calm yourself down, not too giddy. But I'm thinking to myself, if I do everything right here, I'm going to be Leeds' first world champion here. I'm fucking, this fight's mine.
And you think that's the second round?
This is after the first round, going into the second round. I was going to make sure that I keep on the game plan, but don't do anything daft. Don't get too carried away. Again, same that. Gone away, be a little bit cautious, bam, catch him right hand, he goes on, and I've just fucking chased after him then. And that seemed to be just the stamp of the fight. Everything we've worked on, me and my dad, throughout the years, you know, in the gym, anytime the fight had got mentioned, anytime he'd boxed, he'd phone me up, are you watching it? Yep, he's doing that exactly the same thing, isn't he? That left hand's down, yep, go down your right hand side, pop that right hand over the top, yeah, I know, dad, fucking hell. It was coming off and it was just easy. It was like, I could see the fucking punches, what he was doing. Like, everything he was doing, I was preempting the next move and while flying. Sixth round, he gets caught, walking back to the corner, horseman, because I'm just seeing, I'm not hearing everything else. I'm just seeing fucking there's a bit of commotion. I'm not even thinking that fight could potentially be stopped. I'm just thinking, I'm just going to target high, make it more worse. I really didn't really come out of that moment until 8 or 9 rounds in, where Frank Warren got off of his seat and he comes up to the ropes and goes, Josh! And I've turned around. He's gone, fucking 3 rounds, you're going to be a world champion, son. And I'm like, fucking, my dad's going, hey, don't listen to him. You ain't fucking listen to me. Keep to your boxing. And I went out and I'm thinking, I'm jumping around the ring, I'm looking at Lee and he's coming at me. And I'm for about 30 seconds, I'm thinking, fucking hell, I'm going to be world champion. It's hit home. I'm pissing fight. I'm winning comfortably on scorecards. And then I switched myself back on. Bam, got the fight done. Soon as first final bell's done, I've realised fucking hell we are.
When the final bell went, you put your hands up as if you've won it, and then Selby looked as if he knew he'd lost it. But when you got the split decision, what were you thinking? Waiting for the last call out for to say that you'd won? Were you shiting it a bit?
No, I just listened. Even with that call out, normally, I mean, I don't know why it's fucking. It's
you won the match. I thought
they can't fucking they can't do it to us. Mm-hmm. Even when they'd read that scorecard out to him, I was still expecting the next judge to give it to me. I didn't...
Confident?
You know, yeah, just that confident. Like, my dad was like, just wait until I see what happens. But, you know, I've got first one, then they give second one to him. I was just about a bit bemused by that. But then obviously the third one, obviously with myself. But fucking just a little bit weird, really. I never really got nervous about it. Just, well, that's a bit strange, but I'm still going to get it anyway.
Because somebody did say, I don't know if it was in your film I watched last night, you need to relax because we've seen worse decisions being given.
I think my dad.
Yeah.
My dad had said.
Your big man's a character, man. He's bang on the ball, man. So when you got it then, world champion, everything you've worked for, everything that you've studied and trained hard and all the sacrifice, even your missus going to all the fights, that's going to cause a lot of misery. Your dad saying you're proud of you and you've done all that. When you eventually became world champion, dropped to your knees, what were you thinking then?
Done it. We've done it. We've fucking done it, mate. It's all paid off.
It's only the beginning.
And that moment lasted for about a few days. And then it fucking...
And it goes.
And it goes. It goes. And I think that's something else what I've always had. I always strive to be better. I always strive to fucking... And I think that's one of my biggest attributes that I've had. Like I've said many a time in interviews, not the fastest, strongest. I've had a good engine because I've realised that fucking there's no point being tired in that ring. You know, fucking 12 rounds is a lonely place to be. And if you're tired, you can't do fucking anything. You look at footballers when they're on pitch, when the first 10 minutes, they're fresh as fuck. When it starts, if it's been an end-to-end game and they're tired, start making mistakes. Same with boxing. The only difference is you're fucking getting hurt. You know, getting punched to head. You're losing brain cells. You get knocked out. You know, these can change your life completely. We've seen boxers die in the ring. So I've always wanted to be fit. So I've always been fucking strong-minded in that set and worked hard. But this is what it all came down to. All those who fucking ever wrote me off. All them sacrifices, all them things what I've missed out on as a kid. And I'm not just talking about fucking, like, being 18 and 21, like, birthdays. Like that. I was on about this yesterday, actually, with my pals. Like, if I were to take away my boxing career, I would have to take all my childhood, because that shaped all my childhood. You know, I didn't go play football with my fucking on a Sunday with my pals because I did the boxing. I didn't fucking, when they were starting to have a smoke or a drink or whatever, I didn't experiment with that because I did the boxing. Boxing shaped my life. It shaped my outlook on life for the better, obviously, but things would have changed and maybe gone down different routes. Like, different doors would have been set out for me. I still believe that we're given this road on life, and we get to a certain point and we've got decisions to make, and every time you fucking open one of them doors, it goes down another road, and obviously influences can come in and they'll present a door, and then you go through one of them. So that's where that I look at. And so everything in my life had been from a kid, had been fucking centered around, like, boxing. You know, falling into a dental technician, I wouldn't have done that. If I wanted boxing, I might have fucking got into building trade, or I was going to go into fucking Royal Marines at 16. You know, I toyed with that idea. So it all come down to that last, to that fight, to that moment, even though I'd superseded other goals and things, and I should have been satisfied with that. Being the fucking top of the tree, world champion, fucking hell, you're making history now. You're making memories for everyone around you. You're making memories for your team. They're going to elevate themselves off it. My missus had sacrificed her own career as she was in the chefing industry. She put that to one side. You know, now it's not just for me. It's for my kids as well. I've always wanted to do well for my dad, who sacrificed a lot. Now, my dad used to fucking work as a taxi driver. He used to come home from work, pick me up, drive down to Barnsley, because one time I trained in Barnsley, being from Leeds, about 30 miles away. He used to fucking take me up and down country, never obviously getting a penny for that. So I always said, like, if I'd superseded fucking getting a mortgage and a car and drive, then I'd want to pay his mortgage off. You know what I mean? I can't give him time back. That's one thing you fucking can't do. But obviously we work. We give up a lot of our time to work to earn money. So if I can pay his fucking mortgage off, then we can relax a little bit more. My brothers have had to sacrifice a lot. So all these opportunities come from being a world champion, things like meeting people like yourself, meeting fucking, like, you know, first name basis with Leeds United team, or other sports people meet, so they can meet them as well. It all has strings to these things. One of my brothers is registered special needs. So in life, I don't want him to fucking have to struggle. Now, I'm not saying I want to spoil him. Yeah, Marcus says I can't. Yeah, Marcus. But at the same time, he's going to fucking, he lives at home with my old fella at the minute, but he's going to be a part of his life when he's going to be on his fucking own. And I don't want him to be working for a company where they might take piss out of him and stuff like that. I've always been protective, always been a family man. You know, I want to fucking make sure I look after him. I've got a sister, 17-year-old, who's autistic. Now, I'm going to be going to pick her up today. She can't string a sentence together. And, like, she's getting to that stage now where, fucking, after the next few years, where's her life going to go? She doesn't know what she wants to do. Because, bloody hell, half the time, she doesn't know what's going on around her. But I feel that's my responsibility. You know, I've always had that fucking lifting responsibility. Now I say I want to build an empire. You know, my mum and dad split up when they were like 13, 14. And for 2 years, I went on a fucking, on a bad rampage of, I'd come home and they'd be fucking falling out, fighting, and like, my younger brother would fucking break down and say, I felt like I was carrying my family for a long time. My dad would break down, my mum would break down. So I would fucking, it's 15, 16. I had a lot of responsibility on my shoulders at that age. I felt like I was fucking carrying family. Yeah. Daddy'll be all right, mate. Sitting up to him at like 4 o'clock in the morning when I've got work next day. No, fucking, I'll be all right, mate. Fucking hell. My brother's running away from home, fucking going missing. Fucking Tom's gone missing. Where is he? My mum's fucking like crying. Oh, mum, listen, fucking these things happen. I'm doing relationship counselling. I'm then going to like fucking school and work next day with a big smile on my face. Still try to carry on with my own dream. So when I get to this stage, I'm a world champion. All of a sudden, no longer is it, wow, Josh, you've done something there. It's no longer that. It's, fuck me, financially, I can change the life of everybody around me. And I feel like I have that responsibility, James, not only, like I say, my missus and my own kids, my missus sacrificed, but my family, grew up with. So these things it's all come at once, and all of a sudden you think, fuck me, I've gone through a big door here. But I remember going back to change rooms and sitting down with world title, like, fuck me, I've done it. I've absolutely done it. But then a few minutes later, I'm saying, hey, fucking hell, who's next? Yeah. Who's next?
Keep the foot in the floor, because you know you've got to. It's not that you're protecting your family, but now you've got the opportunity to give them a healthy life, bit of stability. And that's all you need in life. You need the kick up, not the kick up the ass, but you need the drive to put your foot in the floor in the morning to go, this is what I need to do. Because if I stop, then, like I say, you're very protective, so you're wanting to help your sister, your brother, your dad, who's been through thick and thin. So the reason why you've probably got a level headed is because you've seen all, it's not easy not having money and the pain and the stresses of life. You've had all the stresses of life at a very young age to realise, I'm going to work and make it no matter what I do.
So you're
going through all those changes. I believe you'll fight Eleanor again. I believe you'll be fighting in America.
Yeah.
This is only the fucking beginning of you. You've built your platform. People love you. And you're only going to get bigger and better to what you're going to achieve, because everything you've set your mind to, you've achieved it. Everything you've visualised, you've achieved it. And I only believe at 29, the next 5 years is just going to be fucking another level again.
It's
unbelievable. After the Selby fight then, what happened next? I know you went out against Frampton
and
you came out swinging first round. We're in fairy tale land.
I mean, fucking, you know, like kids who want to be footballers and that, the comparison to being at top at sport in boxing is kind of like, kids who want to play an FA Cup final. You know, fucking, your drug dealers who want to be Tony Montana. You know, this is where I was. I was fucking at the very, very top of the tree. I never in my wildest dreams thought I'd get to this level. Like I said to you, fucking years prior to this, I was in Manchester Arena thinking, wow, I'd like to be in one of these. Next minute, I'm fighting Carl there, 20,000 people. And it would a case like, I'm here now, I want to be in the big fights. I don't want to have the fucking steady, let's have a like steady first defence. Got offered to fight Carl. And it was like, let's do it, you know. I'd only given a fraction of what I'm capable of doing against Lee. Going into my prime years, the fight got offered against Carl. I'm world champion. He's ranked number one in country. I'm ranked number two. How the fuck does that happen? Only way to find out is and make myself number one is by settling his differences and having a fight. And it was funny because years before that, you know, I'd been to Vegas to watch Carl fight Leo Santa Cruz. Me and my pals had been in, you know, watching that fight, and fucking some of my pals have said, give you an hard night, would Frampton, like, you know, a lot of respect for him. And then next minute I'm fighting him. Fight got made at Windsor Park, but again, massive confidence going into it, and again I were a fucking massive underdog, but I wasn't going to let that attract me, and I never have done since the early days of coming through, getting slagged off by media. I've always been fucking tunnel visioned, and you aren't stopping me getting to my fucking goal. You know, these outside influences, it's my fucking life. I know what happens, and I know what my body's capable, and what I see through my eyes, then that's what I'm capable of doing about something about that. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
listen, I fucking die tomorrow, everything gets switched off. Fucking, you don't exist because bam, I'm gone. But whilst I'm alive and breathing, I can do something about it. And I'm at the fucking top of the game. I'll do absolutely everything to stay at the top of the game, to keep on winning. You keep writing me off, I'm gonna fucking keep on coming. You tell me that I'm not good enough, don't worry about it. You know, it's what happens. The actions speak louder than words.
Million percent.
There we were, and you know, I remember being in the apartment in City Centre, and in Manchester, and again a little bit nervous. I'm thinking, I don't want to be a fucking flashing pan here. I don't want to just win the world title and now I fucking got beat on his first defence. True champion defends his belt at the fucking very top. I'm going in with very, very talented man here in Carl. But massively confident. I trained hard for that one, very, very hard. And it will probably, again, I've gone kind of this next phase of my chapter of my career I've gone into, it's probably the most relaxed I've ever been in. And I'm enjoying everything about it, like pulling into Manchester, fucking, you know, going in the back door where all the artists go, fucking diving out of the car. Hey, up boys, here we are, fucking big fight. Having a giggle in change rooms. Like, I had Liam Cooper, captain of Leeds United, do a ring walk with me. We go around back, it's all quiet and airy. I said, right, Liam, let's fucking, when we start walking at ring, belt nice and high. Shutter goes up, 20,000 people in there that night, fucking half of them's Irish fans, half of them Leeds fans. The fucking noise is pulsating through. People are screaming and shouting at you. Liam's like, fucking hell, I'm going, here we go, boys. Heart's going, but I'm buzzing, I can't wait for it. I'm looking out, fucking marching on the game, it starts ringing round. People are Leeds fans all around the arena are just standing up on their feet. They're fucking, there's half of Irish fans like, wanker, man. But I'm loving it. I'm like, this is fucking stuff you dream of, you know. It's like kids walking out to Wembley or their dream stadium, wherever they want to be, whether it be Ellen Road or fucking wherever the support. It's like them going out to their fucking... So the big platform, that's what I'm doing. I'm fucking living dreaming. I'm getting in ring, getting Carl's, gets in the ring, he's all pumped up. Now, the day before the fight, we'd been at the weigh-in, I'm looking down his fucking, I'm looking into his soul, I'm saying, are you ready, Carl? Are you ready to go to war tomorrow? And he's going, I'm fucking ready, I'm ready, I'm ready. He's getting all pumped up. And I can see veins in his neck fucking starting to get bigger and bigger, rush of blood to Eddie. Now, I were pumped, but I was calm as well. So I'm saying, listen, we're going to war tomorrow, Carl. We're going to war. I fucking meant it. So I didn't have to like get bulled up with it because I meant what I said. And he said, oh, fucking hell, we are. So I don't know if we're putting a bravado on or what, but I'm looking over at him and he's pacing. He's pacing. Bouncing off the ropes. He's staring at me. He's fucking looking away. Now I'm looking. I'm like looking about, fucking trying to catch people's eyes in the crowd. I'm looking. Oh, fucking hell, here we go. Here we go. Another big one. Let's finish the year on a fucking, on a bomb. I've just had a film come out. I've had a fucking film premiere. I've just won world title. All fucking things are going well for me. This is like cherry on top. My kids have been born this year. I dad to twins. Cherry on top. I'm looking out, Carl. Carl's fucking revved. Bang, first bell goes. We go to middle of the ring. Now, Carl's got brilliant fucking footwork and I've seen it for many, many years. Big wide stance, got long jab. He's only small, but it controls distancing really, really well. Goes out with centre of the ring. Now moving about, I'm a lot taller than Carl, but again, it can control distance. It makes you think you're in range and then bam, counter. So I'm being wary. I'm landing a few jabs, bam, snaps his head back, bam, snaps his head back. I've moved forward a bit and Carl's gone, move back really quick. I thought, fuck me, that was quick. If I've got to go forward, I'm going to have to do a lot better than that. There's a bit of fucking tension in the crowd, I can feel it. I'm not really looking at faces, but I can feel tension around everyone's fucking singing songs and that. Moving forward, right here, I fucking go. Inbuilt clock in my head, no, there's about a minute and a half gone. Right here, we fucking go. Push forward, he moves back. He moves to his right, my left. I throw a left hand out. He walks on the way, he stops. As soon as he stops, that's it. Bam, 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 just throw a fucking million punches now. I wanted to get his respect early on. We worked on fucking getting respect early on, putting an implant, putting your impression on him early on in the fight. I'd seen him fight many times and he gets stronger as the fight goes along. I thought, I can't let him build into it. Put impression on me. Dad went, you silly bastard. I said, go fast, but I didn't go that fast. He went, how are you feeling all that? I said, yeah. He said, right, same again, but don't go fucking as wild. Next round come. But I don't know, I've gone forward. I've hit him with a right. He's kind of fell on me. Now, my record doesn't suggest that I'm a big puncher, but ask anybody who I've traded rounds with, and I've traded rounds with some big punchers, I know I can punch. It's just the case that throughout the years, I've just won the fights. I've kind of half pulled the punches. Like even when I've had fighters hurt, I've kind of half pulled them because I don't want to fucking risk going in at full belt, sitting and planting full belt on them and getting caught with my shot myself. So this time, fucking hell, I've not to lose. I'm fucking world champion. So obviously I still want to win, but I'm showing everyone what I'm capable of doing. So bam, I'm sitting on punches. I've hurt him. He's fell on me. Fucking hell, he's going here. So I've pulled back and I've just gone, I thought to myself, land a big one or throw accumulation and like one might get through. So that's why I've just lots of fucking punches, blah, blah, blah. And he's going, but then he's fucking, you know, the man he is, the fighter he is, stood and he's planting himself and we fucking end up having a bit of a ding-dong. But like that's what made it the fight that it was. And throughout that fight, it was just a fucking, I was just buzzing to be in there. Man's like a sick bastard, but I enjoyed that tear up. Like, we're on the ropes and I'm fucking, we're going to war, and like that competitiveness and that like bit of fighting inside me, I've always enjoyed that. I've always enjoyed having a toe-to-toe in ring, in sparring sessions. Now I'm doing it in fucking in a live audience with fucking 20,000 people watching. One of my favourite fights is Marco Antonio Barrera versus Eric Morales, and they just throw kitchen sink at each other, yeah. And me and him are there in trenches, you know, arms are bouncing off each other, uppercuts and hooks are going in, and I'm fucking loving it. I'm buzzing it like it's a fetish or something, you know what I mean? I'm fucking getting a semi on being in there. But
so you won that fight as well.
But that's it, yeah. Fucking what an end to the year. I've beat like a pound for pound great then in Carl Frampton, you know, 2-weight world champion. All of a sudden, we can't call Josh's win a fluke. We can't call his win a fluke. Oh, fucking hell. Now all I want to do is unify. I want to fight another world champion. I want to win another belt. But then I get my mandatory against Kid Gallard, which, you know, what a fucking... I've known Kid for a very long time. I've known him from amateurs. I actually boxed him twice in amateurs. Really, really well-spoken lad. But obviously, people get older, they change, and people get into, you know, certain circles, and acted like a bit of a bell end before press conference, and he was all right after the fight, didn't complain about the result or anything like that, and has since complained about it. But it's just one of them things, you know. I don't fucking hate people who I go in the ring with, because like I say, we give it all, and I know what everyone else goes through. But like I say, that's your moment to sort it all out, and if someone's going to call me a cunt, then I'm going to call him a cunt back. I'm going to make animosity, if it's not there,
stand up for yourself.
We just go fight. Yeah. But if someone's going to start disrespecting you, that's going to do.
Yeah.
I've only had that against Lee Selby and him, so that's why we had a lot of bad blood against there. And yeah, a little bit of a frustrating fight, but same time, someone like that can make you look daft.
Yeah, it seems like you've completed, not the featherweight, you probably, no doubt you probably have still another few fights, but would you ever go up to lightweight?
The next one would be super feather, but yeah, I would do.
Who got Lopez and Lomachenko?
You are, and like in Superfever, you've got lads who've just boxed Leo Santa Cruz.
The Rose fights in sight, yeah.
Tank Davis. Most definitely. Listen, why do you not want to fucking create memories here? You know, I talk about going to Vegas, and I go to 20 states. I keep repeating myself in interviews. People say fucking obsessed with doing that, but I boxed in Berlin in 2015, and I boxed a journeyman, just a bit of a tickover fight before I boxed in the Tuberon fight. And the memories, what I've heard from there, like people, when I talk to people who went over there, I think about 500-600 people went over. They've got glint in their eye. You know, they reminisce on that story. Whatever they got up to. I don't want to repeat on camera, I don't want to expose names, but whatever got up to them in Berlin, them fucking super clubs and all that, them brothels and whatnot.
I didn't know there was any of that.
But You're making memories for folk.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Good memories as well.
Yeah, listen, I had some of my mates' granddads come away from, and family members like, fucking hell, that's one of the biggest things, best sporting events I've ever been to. My mates' granddads crying. Like, fucking hell, how proud. You've had a dint in people's lives. You've made a fucking... And not many people get to do that. Like yourself, you'll reach out to people and it'll spiral on. People will listen to you talk. You'll make a dint in their life. It'll be affected, might change the way they think. Sports people do that, influences to a certain degree do that. Sometimes the wrong influences, you know, fucking look at other people as, you know, reality TV and maybe the wrong influence. But to make an influence on someone's life and be part of their life is quite a thing. You've made a memory of somebody. I've had people who come to my show who've met birds and they're still with them now and they've started a family. Some people talk about fucking times when they've won a lot of money at the fights or something's happened or whatever, but you've made an implant on their life and it made an impression. And after I retire, I would like people to say, hey, do you remember when we fucking went to Manchester that time? You remember Ellen Road? Do you remember when we went to Vegas? So all them things that are in front of me right now, you know, I want to fucking go win belts. I want to create a legacy, not just for myself, but for, you know, kids off at a state, realise that, listen, don't get involved in all that stuff.
Yeah.
No, just keep doing what you're doing. Stay focused. I want to build an empire for my family, you know, for not to be flash guns and drive down in fancy stuff.
Give them a bit of freedom. Just,
yeah, it's time, isn't it? Yeah. It's time. That's what we all strive to have, more time.
Be able to go on holidays that you want.
Exactly,
and stuff like
exactly.
And I wouldn't say you're rag to riches. You've came from nothing. You've worked hard, consistency, visualisation, staying away from the bad things in life. You wouldn't be where you are today if you'd got sidetracked, if you drifted through drink, drugs, whatever it was, maybe their own choice and what. You always believed that you were going to make it, but you also believed that you needed a backup plan, which is fucking mega to even have that strategy in your mind at such a young age. And now you're doing it. You're living proof that you can achieve anything you want. I believe this is only the beginning for you. I believe you're just going to go right into the stratosphere and fucking take right over, man. Yeah. Your belief system's second to none. Your backing from the fans is second to none. I think that's your second wind, because you know you've got the fucking full city behind you.
Yeah.
It's not as if you're not letting anybody down. No matter what happens in your career now, you'll never let anybody down, but you've still got that inside you. You're letting your family down, and you're letting fans down. You've not.
And that's a fire inside, James. It's like there's been times after fights I've come back fucking absolutely devastated. Like, what's up? You've just won. You've just won. But I'm thinking I could have done better. I could have made it more entertaining. I said to you beforehand, there's been times when I've watched my football team fucking and players not giving half effort, and I know that people are paying their hard-earned money to watch you fight, and it might be only time they go out that month. You know, they might not get the luxury of going out. It might be only time they go out that fucking year. You know, might have just come from like only got into a job and it's the first payback. They're coming to watch, spending money to come watch you. You've got to fucking give absolutely everything.
Yeah, I think
you've got to give absolutely everything.
So you're back now with Eddie Hearn. What's the plans for the future then for you?
So after having three defences of world title now, ranked number one in fucking still mad thinking about that. Rank number one.
Big cheese on your face. It's good to see, bro.
Yeah. I never get really too fucking caught up on it. You know what
you
mean?
Should
I
mean, though, man. Enjoy it as well.
I know that is the fine balance. That is a fine balance. I mean, world
because you don't want to become across a cocky bastard.
Listen,
my
world title's in my fucking shoe cupboard at home downstairs. All rest of belts are fucking in my office somewhere. Look, listen, it's a fine balance, isn't it? You don't want to get too cocky, but at the same time, you've got to appreciate, because like, you don't want to retire and think, bastard, I really enjoyed that.
Yeah.
So I enjoy myself from time to time while I fucking have a joke on the lad, but fucking hell. My dad takes piss out of me. My best pals around me, they're fucking silicone. You'll get in with next fight, you're going to get your ass handed to you.
Yeah.
They would, before Lee Selby fight, they were saying, hey, Selby's going to fucking pag you, mate. You know, we're playing five-a-side and they'd say, listen, Selby wouldn't have lost ball, you shit cunt, fucking. Yeah. And I'd be like, I'm running about all over, you know, it's people, my circle around me is the same circle that I've always had, and they only come into it like, I don't let people in straight away, do you know what I mean? And I want open and honesty. I don't want people coming round licking my ass and fucking telling me I'm great and fantastic. Mm. I want people who are just going to be straight with me. I think that's very important. I've had agents who've come by and saying they could take me to the stars and back, and then realise that they're just...
The fellowship.
Yeah, they're in it for themselves, and that's it, to quick, make a quick quid. But yeah, mate, fucking hungry. I'm not finished yet. Yeah, I'm not finished yet. Whilst ever I'm a professional boxer, I want to carry on doing what I'm doing. I want to, like I say, I've images already of being in Vegas, seeing fucking 5,000 people get off of planes, walking from the airport, walking that street,
more than that,
smashing casinos,
tables and fucking chairs everywhere.
What a fucking weekend we've had! Listen, I've got pals, older pals who've said, listen, we've got credit cards ready and waiting to go. Mm-hmm. We've got credit cards waiting and ready to go. As soon as you give that blue light, mate, fucking that green light, sorry, we're going. We're going to be there, and like, you can't buy that loyalty. But this is people who've met over the years. And I'll go before the fight, I'll have like an orange juice in pub with them, or a cup of tea at their house. And after the fight, listen, thank you for coming. You know, go shake their hand. Do you enjoy it? What were your night like? And they're telling me their experiences. And I'm making these memories for people, and they're solid. They'll be with me till the day I die. Throughout my career, they'll be there to the end of it. But yeah, we signed with Eddie after having my defences. And, you know, at the start of the year, the goal was simple, you know, get a unification fight and then go to America. Like I say, that's what I said I wanted to do. My contract expired with Frank, and then I think Eddie just had the better contacts in the States. Mm. Said he's fucking, since being away from Eddie, he's boomed and boomed and boomed and got bigger and bigger.
But so have you.
Yeah, well, this is it. And I think as soon as he heard that I was out of contract, yeah. I lied to my manager. Let me fucking make him an offer. Yeah. And it was a little bit weird because we met in Sheffield at some...
Was there no bad blood then?
No, listen. You'll see him from the film.
He actually looked okay, but he looked gutted as well.
Yeah, I think he was. I think it was a little bit of frustration from my dad's side and my manager's side that things weren't really happening as quick as they wanted to.
It's business though, isn't it?
It is, mate. It is. And obviously, in them times when I've been away, he's had the success with Anthony Joshua. He's had success with the fighters in the States. It's fucking, he's a meme now, isn't he? So.
He's fucking loved. I think the guy for what he does is unbelievable. It gets a lot of stick as well.
He does. And you know, I'm not going to lick his arse here because I'm a promoter, but when you look at the fans are spoiled these days and they don't realise, like I said to you earlier, when I first turned pro, shows were done in leisure centres. Now, from a fighter's point of view, it's fucking brilliant because, like, you know, a lot of times when fighters get contracts, they get sponsors and stuff like that, and it's massive opportunities. Fighters are becoming household names again, and I will say that Eddie has been a massive part in that, you know, getting the shows from like fucking leisure centres to arenas and making fighters household names. And obviously that's give all the other promoters a kick up their ass, and give Frank a kick up ourselves. Mm-hmm. So then he's doing things a little bit differently now, even little things like playing music in between fucking rounds and having certain playlists to get the fighters. Everyone knows that Sweet Caroline's part of a big boxing night now. You know, I think Eddie's been part of that makeup, so very, very clever. But yeah, when we met up, it was like a bit of a seedy meet in a fucking hotel down in Sheffield. I think he had a show down there, and when he walked in, it was just like, all right, mate, all right, Ed. You know, fucking, and obviously there would have interest a few other promoters as well, you know, stateside. And over here, Eddie's with Sky and everything else, he's doing fantastic and he's built a good relationship. So, you know, we joined back forces with him, and the deal was like, we're going to have a unification fight over here. And we were set to fight in Headingley at the rugby stadium in June. Obviously, while this is fucking front a spat in the works.
Lockdown, you're the missus and the kids.
You know what? It's been a blessing. I mean, you've always got to take. I always try to take positives out of everything. Always, you have to do. You have to do. Well, you can't fucking sulk and mope about it, mate. I'd say, for instance, like just being home with kids. When I've got a fight on, I don't go away for camps, but I'm not home. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, when I was... me and Mrs. had kids fucking 12 weeks before Selby fight. They were born 12 weeks before Selby fight. There were times when I was fucking helping her feed. We've got twins. I was helping her feed, mate, and fucking half 3 in the morning. And it was like 5 weeks before a fight, and I'm like, what the fuck am I doing? I'm fighting for a world title in like 5 weeks' time. What am I doing? And even when I was spending time with home, playing with them as kids and stuff, I'm not really putting my full energy because subconsciously I'm thinking about the fight. It takes over your life. It's like, lose that, I'm done. I'm fucking, that's me, bomb, hype, bubble, gone. I put everything into that. I put absolutely everything into it. So then after that, I was straight into the Frampton fight and blah, blah, blah. So the fights have always been keeping busy. And it's like, she's like, oh, do you remember when they used to wear that? She keeps all, you know, fucking clothes on that. Like, fucking, I've never seen him in that. Do you know what I mean? Like, times where I'm sacrificing, I want to go out. Mm-hmm. So this initial bit has given me a lot of time with them, just to be fucking dad. You know, just be daddy. Do you know what I mean? And I've got to know my kids a lot better, even though I fucking live at home and like I train, I have my camps at home. I've got to know my kids like fucking never before. And you know, I absolutely love it. It's all fucking, it's precious, mate. It's precious. And I want to have more kids, but I won't do it until I retire because I'll never get it that back, that initial time what I've missed with them. And I've also used this time, I've got my own gym to, you know, fucking work on other parts of my game.
How does your missus and that, when she's, I know she goes to all your fights, how is it nerve-wracking for them coming to see fights?
You know what, she's pretty cold, my missus, like, in that. She's pretty cold, she's always been. She's emotional, like, since she's a kid, she's more and more emotional, but like, she displays her emotions in other ways. Like, I'd never cry. I don't seem to fucking cry at funerals or shit like that, which I think is a fucking weird thing.
Yeah,
I mean,
but that's nerves.
But yeah, but like, she'd be in tears. But then other things like that, like, I think it's the belief that she has in me. I don't know. Just we bounce off over each other in that respect. And I, when she, we always stay here, like in one of the suites, and I always say to her, like, Tash, fucking, I always just embrace her and say, fucking, if anything happens, I fucking love you too, you know, blah, blah, blah. And off she'd go. But she, like, she'd never be worried. I think the only time she were ever worried were fucking just before the Selby fight, because I'd built it up and everyone else had built it up for that much. And we had that bit of animosity. I mean, fuck me. She was sat ringside against Martin Lindsay. And in the 11th round, man, I don't remember this, fucking, my decent chin. He hit me with a right hand. I don't remember the shot. And she was sat there so she could see my face. And as I got hit with the shot, she said my fucking eyes went to the back of my head and I fucking come back round. And she's like, fucking worries about things like that. She worries about me when I'm coming down off adrenaline, because after fights, I'm that, get that hyped up. I'm fucking, you know what I mean? I'm on a different planet. But then I've got to come down and I'm like, I come into a bit of trembling. If you've not seen it, it looks nasty. And I'm like, I'm chattering and stuff. She worries about them things and stuff. But, you know, she's got confidence in me. She knows what I'm sacrificing. She knows the belief. And she realises that
you need that support, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You've also got your own podcast out. Cheeky bastard. Yeah. He's what, the world champion now coming into my world, eh?
Competitors, mate. We're taking over it all. Putting this energy into the pod, yeah.
Your podcast about, and where can people get in about
that? That's on YouTube. It's Josh Warrington. Is it Josh Warrington? Josh Warrington.
We'll leave the links in the description, so get subscribing, guys. Is it on iTunes and stuff as well?
Not yet. I mean, fucking media team's fucking useless.
Fucking these guys.
We're useless, but we're on going with it. You know, I think it's me and my dad doing it. We're interviewing just like yourself. We're going to be branching out different people. We started a lot of sports people from Leeds, but try to be as raw as possible. I think a lot of these pods, what are going on. Sometimes it's like too serious and whatnot. I know I've been fucking serious in here, but. Just like my dad's raw, have you seen on the film?
Love a big man, yeah, he's just a big character.
He's raw, mate, he's raw.
It doesn't look as if he's fuck about, but that'd be good for you. We will probably clash, you need that as well.
It gets a giggle out, and that's what we tried to get on with pods. We get laughs out and stuff like that. But it's going all right, mate. It's going out, building up that. Mm-hmm. So yeah, subscribe if you fucking enjoyed listening to me. But,
it's what you've done and what you've achieved so far, brother, is unbelievable. It's phenomenal coming from basically fuck all to be working away and chipping away to now being world champion, undefeated, now get your family, now get an income, and now talking about hitting America, Ellen Road possibly, all the biggest fights in the world. It's phenomenal, brother. I'm proud of you, and I can't wait to see the rest of your journey.
I appreciate that, genuinely.
And the support you've got, even the boys are here, have been fucking nothing but nice. The setup's been class. Yeah. Would you like to finish up on anything, anybody that's maybe wanted to be a boxer or understanding maybe fitness is key for mental health, whatever. Do you like to finish up on anything?
Maybe say a few things. Like I say there, you've got to have good people around you. Make sure you surround yourself with good people. I think within a few weeks, few months, you'll start to realise the bad people around you are no good for you. If they're not striving, if you don't get motivated off them people around you, if they're just feeding you constantly with negative and bad news and sad news, then, you know, unless like they're family members or whatever, you've got to cut loose, you've got to get rid of them in order to just go forward, because they're going to only hold you back. Listen, we're not fucking, if you aren't being in that scenario yourself, experience is the best teacher, but the second best thing to it is listening. Now, there's a lot of focal, especially if you're younger, if you've not been in certain scenarios, there's a lot of people who've lived and they've been in certain scenarios and they fucking might have done things what you can't even dream of. Listen, because even if it's not directly linked to your field, you can take a lesson from that. I mean, I'll give you an example. I've met fucking people, I do a lot with forces, listen to, you can imagine, some gruesome stories of people of what they've been in. At the same time, I do a lot of work with charities and I do a lot of work with children's charities. Now, I always try to help children's charities out whenever I can. And you might moan about fucking summer, might get stuck in traffic, flat tyre, whatever. Fucking, you missed out on a new pair of Yeezys, what have just been launched. It don't fucking matter. And this is like listening and learning, but it's at the same time putting things into perspective. Now, I do a lot of things, work with charity, like I said. Most of them, Candlelight is an ambassador for them. They work on children's cancer. I do a lot with Children's Art Ward as well. Times I've been down there and I've seen kids fucking, you know, position, mate, she'll go down, show the belt off, help raise the profile of the charity. And I've seen kids down there fucking in rooms with one of the parents and that's all allowed in, fucking machines coming out of them. Or I've been in arts wards and there's dads who've just been in and out to work and they've had phone calls because the kid at fucking 5-6 year old have had heart attacks. Fucking heart attacks at 5-6 year old. And you think, wow, they're kids, man. They should be fucking out and about playing, worrying about how many TikTok followers they've got or, you know, have they got the latest trainers? And not things like that, life, you know, threatening illnesses. So there's always fucking people out there a lot, you know, worse than you. And it really puts things into perspective. So learn from that. I've certainly learned from that. Fucking any time I'm going to think I'm going through something bad, I have like aches and pains, I think, fuck that. There's always someone worse off.
Yeah, 100%.
And fucking hell, I'm going to say on my last one. Finally, whatever you're going to do, whether it's sport or business, just give it 100%. And nothing's ever going to go rosy for you. Listen, 30-0, number one in world.
Get it out there.
But it's not always been as fucking easy as that. It's not always been as easy as that. And you speak to anybody, yourself, setting up this pod, you'll have come through the things in your life. Everybody who has been successful will have come through. And that adds a bit of resilience. You're able to bounce back from that. If it don't go right, then fuck it. Dust yourself off. Go the next day. In this day and age, everybody wants instant success. They want to be trending every time they put a photo out or whatever. Life ain't fucking perfect. Everybody who's got them perfect pictures out there, that ain't always as it seems. You have to go through a bit of hardship, but don't break you. Don't think you're the only one that's happening to. Take it as a lesson. Dust yourself off. Get going again. And the more good energy you fucking put out there, it will come back. It's kind of like karma.
Unbelievable, brother. Josh, it's been an absolute pleasure, mate. On. And all the best for the future. Great Top story, on. Mate. Should be Top proud. On.
Appreciate Cheers. That.
Check out more of my podcasts on the right and be sure to like, share and comment your thoughts on this week's podcast. Thank you.